afternoon, everyone, and I hope I don't put you to sleep right away post lunch. I'll anyway start with this. So today's session, I'm going to talk on, basically it's based on some studies that we have done, and it's on the XNCEL counters, as it's mentioned here. When we say differentiation of febrile illnesses, basically we looked at, we could actually talk, I'll be talking about two particular illnesses, dengue and scrub typhus. The focus here is on what we call hemocytomorphometry, that is morphology as analyzed from the cell counters. So I'll not spend much time into epidemiology of diseases so that we can delve into the topic per se. I'll be covering a little bit about the study on dengue and scrub typhus, and then cover other relevant aspects of them in the clinical settings, like what happens when platelet counts are down and sepsis, what do you see, and so on. So these, as you know, as listed here, some of the most common acute febrile illnesses, and many times some of which are differential diagnosis of each other when you don't have specific tests. And dengue, I'll not, you know, this part is very familiar to you. So I'll just say the brunt of the problem is the lower part here. More than 50 to 100 million annual cases, and in the Southeast Asian region, if you can see the number of people at risk, it's 1.3 billion. Now this is only in the Southeast Asian region. We have the other side of the world as well, Brazil, Mexico, and so on. And last year we had an epidemic right there in India as well. So it's a leading cause of hospitalization and death among children. And dengue has been, of course, WHO in 2009 revised the classification by adding a dengue. It was dengue hemorrhagic fever shock syndrome. Now it's dengue and severe dengue. Okay, I'm not going into details there. Now, diagnostics in dengue have always been a problem. Why? Because you have certain tests. You have the NS1, the non-structural protein 1. You have IgM ELISA. You have IgG ELISA. The most specific, of course, would be the PCR, where you can detect the viral copies. But then, you know, in resource-limited settings, which is probably most of India and neighboring places, it's a major issue. And again, at what point these particular, the non-structural protein, the IgM, becomes positive, very, for a very narrow period. And IgG is very non-specific. Now, if there is an episode of secondary dengue, then IgG just overshadows the whole thing. And you don't know if this IgG is due to the current infection, is it due to the primary dengue infection, or is it a cross-reactive IgG from another infection. So a lot of issues there in diagnostics, right? Coming to scrub typhus, it's a recurrent disease, bacterial, okay? So Oriensia suzugamishii is the organism, thrombocytoid vector. Again, the clinical finding, if it's there, very good, well and good, it helps in your diagnosis, the SCAR. But a point to be noted, among Southeast Asian places, including India, in up to 80%, you may not see. They say the SCAR is seen in 20 to 80% of cases. But in the Indian setting, if it's there, well and good. If it's not there, this thing, it's a problem. And then, of course, again, coming to diagnostics, Weill-Felix test, this has been there for ages. Apparently, this test was introduced as early as 1915, if I'm not wrong. And it's there, it's easily accessible. A lot of people do it, why it's very cheap. But the question is the reliability. There have been studies which have shown that Weill-Felix test sensitivity is around 33% and specificity is under 50%. So that's how much it will help you in routine clinical practice. Then there are more tests, again, complement fixation, indirect immunofluorescence antibody test. And again, not many centers do all these tests. So what we set out to see is what we can gain out of the cell counters in these conditions. Now, what we do know is that peripheral blood changes unnoted morphologically when there is an acute febrile illness. The changes may be in the neutrophils, in the lymphocytes, in the platelets. Okay, we are familiar with all these changes. We'll come to that in a little bit. So, and what we also know is that cell counters as per se are very sensitive to changes in the blood, however subtle they may be. And also what these changes can be even missed by an experienced eye. So the point is we need to know that apart from just giving us numerical data in terms of, say, cytosis or cytopenias, what more can the cell counter tell us? Can it give us more data? Can you help us predict certain diseases by terms of some of the parameters it has? Okay, like on the older series platforms, you might have the XC series, you must be heard about the NUTX, NUTY, and so on. So whether these parameters, anything from the cell counter will help us predict certain diseases. That's what we set out to see. Sorry. So this is just brief. The principle of fluorescence flow cytometry, okay? So you have a laser, you have the interrogation chamber, the cell passes through, and based on how it hits and what point it goes, you get the parameters, the forward scatter, the size, site scatter, the internal complexity, the organelles, and the site fluorescence based on the nucleic acid content. I'm not going into the details of this. We'll try to go into the X encounter what we find. So coming to the first chamber, which is the WDF chamber, the differential counting chamber, it uses a permeating reagent and a fluorochrome, which is a polymethane dye. So the degree of fluorescence is proportional to the amount of nucleic acid present. And what we do know is that RNA stains better than DNA. So this is how you find it on a normal WDF scattergram, okay? These are the various cell populations in its specific locations, strategically gated and segregated, right? Now in help of this cartoon, I'll show you what happens when a reagent, okay, in this WDF chamber, you have the permeating reagent and you have the fluorochrome dye. So when there are pores in the membrane by the reagent, the dye will enter and go to where the nucleic acid is, so which is here in the nucleus. And this, the cell will have a partial collapse because of the permeation, and you get these particular parameters. Okay, you have your forward scatter, your side fluorescence, and your side scatter. So this is what a normal differential count on a WDF chamber would look like in a normal case. Okay, well segregated population of cells, the cell population data is all evident over here. This is the side fluorescence versus side fluorescence versus forward scatter. Coming to the next chamber, which is the WNR chamber, where you get the total count, the NR bases, and the basophils. Okay. Now, principle here we need to know is that the cells with high acidic cytoplasmic content resist lysis or shrinkage by the reagent and therefore appear in a near native size. Now, here that would be basically in the basophils. Why? Because they have heparin in the cytoplasm. Heparin is probably the most acidic substance in the human body with a pH of around 1. So we have heparin, which has acid in cytoplasm. And then the other thing, one other good example would be RNA in reactive lymphocytes. Okay, so these cells will resist lysis to some extent and therefore maintain their size. And NRBCs are bare nuclei basically with lower fluorescence than the WBCs. So in the WNR chamber, when you have, yes, so when you have a low pH, okay, the reagent with low pH, when you compare a basophil with the other cell, what happens? The other cell would shrink, but this would resist the lysis because of its heparin grains in the cytoplasm. And then when it's interrogated, as is obvious, it will show at a higher size, near native size is there. And the fluorescence will also be high because of the acidic content. So what happens in the WNR chamber? I'm not sure some of the cells are actually clear here. Anyway, as mentioned, so cells, when we look at cells having acid in the cytoplasm like heparin in basophils and RNA in reactive lymphocytes and blasts, they tend to be higher up on the forward scatter as well as the side fluorescence because of the near nativity in the size as well as the increase in the acidic content of the cytoplasm, which is why, you know, I'm not sure you can actually make out that the basophil region would be somewhere around here, and you would have, if NRBCs are present, the later erythroblasts would be here and the immature ones would be a little higher. And side fluorescence, of course, as mentioned, reflects the nucleic acid content, and it will go in the series from here, from the erythroblast to neutrophils, eosinophils, immature granulocytes, lymphocytes, and finally the blast at the other end. Okay. Now to show you more in detail about the NRBCs we were talking, I'll show you the next case. This one was a case we got a couple of days back. I just added a slide yesterday. This case is still under workup. It's a 60-year-old lady still under workup for a possible diagnosis of CML. It was not presenting very classically because the total count was only around 15,000, but there was eosinophilia, there was basophilia, there were NRBCs, there was a good left shift, a few blasts, and so on. So that workup is still going on, but I thought I would show you this picture, tell you where the NRBCs fall. I'm sure you understand. So this is where the basophils will fall, all right? So because there is some basophilia in this case, basophils are here, lot of left shift and immature, therefore there's a clumping of the population here, and then you have your late nomoblasts here, and then the immature ones, which have more, because they're immature, they're called basophilic nomoblasts, right? A lot of RNA in the cytoplasm, immature forms, they'll come higher up on the side fluorescence scale as well as the forward scatter. So coming to the study, we use the SysMex XN9000, and the samples were run on the CBC and the differential mode within 4 hours of collection. Peripheral smears were also seen, and they were we used the modified dry GM sustain. Clinical details collected from the database and the scattergram and cell population data were studied. We set up reference ranges for the cell population data. For this, we used healthy blood bank donors and samples from 449 such people were used, samples were analyzed within 4 hours of collection, and the results were checked for normal distribution. Reference range calculated mean plus or minus 2 standard deviations, and these are the values we got for the various parameters. Now here you can also see there is an interesting parameter here called HFLC, which is high fluorescent lymphocyte percentage, which the normal we set up the range as 0 to 0.96. This is a key factor parameter that I'll be talking about today because it helps us a lot in our study. So I'll show you this. A 5-year-old girl with fever, I'm not sure these appear as they should, but anyway, a 5-year-old girl with fever, or let's just put it as a 5-year-old girl with an acute febrile illness. So let's just concentrate on the WDF pattern here. You have the regular cell populations, you have the lymphocytes there, monocytes here, neutrophils there, some eosinophils, and then you also see another population right up there, which is almost at the same level of the lymphocytes, but very high on the side fluorescence scale, right? So let us compare this with, say, abnormal mononuclear cells, where you get one clump of cluster of cells in the cells where you're supposed to get blast or abnormal cells. Okay. So, and here, of course, these are examples of other abnormal mononuclear cells or other abnormal cell populations, like in an ALL, AML, CML, CLL, where you can't actually segregate them actively and they all appear in the abnormals as a single cluster. All right. So what I'm trying is that we need to contrast the abnormal cell population with a reactive pattern, which is something like this, which this is the enlarged form of, not the case which I showed you before, but of a reactive pattern of in a case of acute febrile illness. So what I'm trying to show here is you have your distinct cell populations, lymphocytes, monocytes, and your granulocytes, eosinophils, and so on, and then you have on the same level as the lymphocytes, there are events higher, very high up on the side fluorescence scale. So why are they high up? So something which is high, nucleic acid content in the cytoplasm, will tend to fluoresce higher, and they appear very high on the side fluorescence scale. So here what we are trying to say is the presence of the reactive lymphocytes, okay, which have abundant adenocytes. They are the deep blue cells if you see on the Romanowski stain smear. So this reactive pattern, you can actually compare it to an hourglass. Hourglass, if you remember, you know, you have a bottom pumper, a small one, and the narrow neck in between, okay? So you can see this one here, and they're connecting. May or may not be seen in all cases. So this reactive pattern that you see is actually because of this, it's this kind of cells which actually appears in that region. Reactive lymphocytes, deep blue cytoplasm, we might call them atypical, but they're actually very rich in RNA, therefore they are what some people actually call as virocytes and viral infections, right? So in our study cohort, we have dengue cases were selected how? There were cases of fever with a clinical suspicion of dengue and confirmed to be positive by serology, either IgM or NS1. Now IgG cases were there, but they were not analyzed along with the other cases because of the reasons I told you, the poor specificity. And accordingly, we got around 168 cases. Equal number of controls were taken, which had a similar suspicion clinically, but were serology negative. And similarly for scrub typhus, cases with a clinical suspicion, positive serology by IgM, cases 96, control similar number, but serology negative. So what we see in dengue cases is that we find a significant lymphocyte response very high on the side fluorescence scale and numerous atypical lymphocytes on smear, as we just shown you. So look at the WDF channel in different cases of dengue, okay? This is the pattern I was trying to tell you, the hourglass pattern where you find a population here and then a narrow neck and a population there. Now that population cells could vary, but you usually do see it, okay? That's what we found actually in varying proportions in that particular region. You can note it may be as high as this, as little as this, but they're there in at least most of the cases. So now, this one, this is what we are going to get as a parameter called HFLC, high fluorescence lymphocyte cell percentage. But suppose you have an older version of the analyzer, or if this parameter is not available for you, so we try to see if we could bring some objectivity rather than I can say, okay, here there is a significant number of cells, here there are hardly any or very few cells. Could we bring some objectivity to this particular cell population there? So what we tried next is, we tried grading this particular cell population, okay, the one right there on top, sorry, one right there on top. We tried grading the cell population. So we took around, if I'm not around 70, 75 cases, and we tried grading, like, if I can call this a 0, where there are hardly any cells there, and this a 10, and everything in between, like 2, 4, 6, 8, how do we three investigators tried to independently sit and do this grading thing.
And one of the investigators was myself, and two of my colleagues did this. And when we independent graded, we found that the inter-observer agreement was quite high, 98% or so, and showed a positive correlation with the HFLC percentage with a linear correlation coefficient of 0.7. So these are the cells that we see on the peripheral smear in these cases, which is actually responsible for the population that come in that particular region, right? These large cells with deep blue cytoplasm. So therefore, what we're trying to say is that in dengue, you have this high fluorescent lymphocyte cell percentage occurring at the higher end of the site fluorescence scale. And this is the parameter, the research parameter that tells you about that. Now, in our study, we found that the percentage, the HFLC percentage gave a better correlation than the absolute numbers, okay? So statistically, what we found, we tried to plot a receiver operating characteristic, the ROC curve, to see where our findings fit in. And this is basically a curve which you plot your sensitivity with 1 minus specificity. Basically, what we're trying to say is this on the y-axis are the true positives, on the x-axis are the false positives. So an ideal case scenario will be you want a 0 on your x-axis and a 1 on your y-axis, right? No false positives, absolutely 100% true positives. And basically, this curve is actually a trade-off between the two, between the true and the false positives. So what we found is that at a cutoff value of HFLC 1.4%, okay, we can predict a case of dengue from this using this parameter with a sensitivity of 82% and specificity of over 90%. Okay, with the area under the ROC curve 92.16. Okay, so and when you plot a box plot for the same studies, okay, I'm showing you cases versus controls. Okay, control population here, dengue positive cases here. On a box plot, basically, I'm telling this is the 25th centile, this is the 75th centile. This is your mean, this is your median. As you can see very clearly, the 25th centile of the cases is much higher than the 75th centile of the control. So you can know that there's a significant difference in the HFLC in the two. Of course, these are the outliers which are not considered. So you can see that here as well. When the controls show a mean of around 0.7, you have cases showing a mean of over 8. The other thing we try to do now, subcategorize these patients based on their day of presentation to see how the HFLC fell in with relation to the day of presentation. And again, we found an interesting finding. So we plotted, we take them on day 2, 4, 3, 4, 5, 6, up to day 10, and we saw, try to see what the pattern shows. And what we found is that the HFLC shows a peak on day 5, right? This is what we found. On day 5 of infection, and thereby tends to drop, as you can see here, okay? Another concept, pseudobasophilia in dengue. Must have heard of it, especially on the older platforms, that when there's dengue, there is pseudobasophilia, which is, of course, not seen on the smear. So what happens there? It's all the principle that we just mentioned, okay? Basophils, heparin in the cytoplasm, high acidic content, therefore rhesus lysis. In dengue, what do you see? The reactor lymphocytes, lot of RNA in the cytoplasm, therefore rhesus lysis, fall in the same region, get counted together, pseudobasophilia, right? So on the XN series, on the current one which we are studying, I'm just showing you the WDF channels and the corresponding WNR channels. Okay? You can see, so this is, of course, this is the basophil region, you know that, right? So when we see a high population here, you find there's a cell population there, little lesser here, hardly anything there, hardly anything here, and barely you can make out anything because there's nothing there as well. So the question here on the XN counter, is there pseudobasophilia? The answer is no. It is not pseudobasophilia, it's pseudobasophilia. I'll tell you why. So on the XN series, there is a gating strategy such that there's an internal gating which you don't see, such that anything before this line, whatever falls there is counted as basophils, and what is beyond that, which are probably the reactor lymphocytes, your blasts and so on, get counted after that. Or they're actually segregated and not counted as basophils. Therefore, now I would say that this entity of pseudobasophilia is actually a pseudo-pseudobasophilia. That entity doesn't exist. Okay. Then coming to scrub typhus, we'll go back briefly to dengue for certain other parameters, but I'll come back to that later. So scrub typhus, now scrub typhus is a bacterial, a rickettsial disease. So apart from your reactor lymphocytes, you also have a strong neutrophil response. Okay. Therefore, you find atypical lymphocytes, and you find neutrophil response in the form, when you talk on scattergrams and scatter plots here, you find a reduced forward scatter and an increased side fluorescence. So why does all this happen? We'll come to that. So on the WDF channel, when you compare a normal case, a normal, okay, well-segregated populations, this is the additional plot where I'm plotting it against FSE to show you what the changes happened there. I'm showing you two cases of scrub typhus here, WDF, and it's WDF only, but side flow, side scatter, side fluorescence versus forward scatter. As you can see, there is a shift of this cell population like upwards. Can you see that? So that is basically what I'm trying to say is there's an increase in the side fluorescence, okay, compared to this increase in the side fluorescence. And if you look at this population compared to the normal, there's a decrease in the forward scatter. See, you can see that the neutrophils here and the lymphocyte well segregated, here it's almost pushing into the lymphocyte region, a decrease in the forward scatter as you can see here. All right. So why does all this happen? We'll have to give some explanation for that. We'll come to it. Right. So we found that from our study that we can predict a case of scrub typhus with a sensitivity of 62.5, specificity of nearly 90, positive predict value of nearly 90, and a negative predict value of nearly 60% if you get this, an HFLC of more than 0.9 and a neutrophil forward scatter of less than 83. Either that, and if by any chance your neutrophil forward scatter is more than 83, you just add one more parameter, your neutrophil side fluorescence, if it's more, if it has gone more than 55, then again you get the same statistics for diagnosing or predicting a case of scrub typhus. So putting that in blocks, box plot patterns, this is what you find. I'm showing you the HFLC, neutrophil side fluorescence, neutrophil forward scatter, cases, sorry, controls on the left, cases on the right, okay. HFLC is increased compared to the controls, side fluorescence also increased compared to the controls, and forward scatter decreased in the cases compared to the controls. Then we try to subcategorize. Among the scrub typhus patients, the same parameters, how do they fall when you look at a case scrub typhus without complications and a case of scrub typhus with complications. Now the complication could be ARDS, multi-organ dysfunction syndrome, or pneumonia, whatever, any complication. And again, among, even within scrub typhus cases, those without complications, the ones with complications show this, okay, no complications and ARDS or complications. The side fluorescence is still higher in cases with complications and forward scatter still lower in cases with complications. So that was also there among the subset. So then we also had to look for response to therapy. Now we know that doxycycline is specific therapy for scrub typhus. So we had to try to look for response to therapy. However, here I will not comment much because we had very few numbers whom we could actually follow up. You know, people don't stay in hospital that long and we could not follow up all the cases. So numbers were too few. So we cannot, I will not make any statements here, but I will say we noted a trend. And that trend is that the side fluorescence seemed to show a decrease or to normalcy with therapy up to by day 8. That is one trend that we noticed in this. So basically what I'm trying to say is, as I showed earlier, is putting it more in a simplified manner. If you have an HFLC of more than 0.9, increased neutrophil side fluorescence, you can predict a case of scrub typhus in about 90% of cases with those parameters. So I'm just showing you some cases where the side fluorescence is increased. Now there was a thought that probably the increase in side fluorescence in these cases is because there is a left shift. Okay, that is immature granulocytes are present, and that is why there is an increase in side fluorescence in these cases. So we needed to see, now even when there's an increase in side fluorescence, you can see that there's a shift of the population of WNI channel to the right, okay, increase in the fluorescence. So we need to see if this is true. We just looked into a couple of cases. So here's a case where the side fluorescence is not increased. Actually, I'm not sure you can make out. There is actually a cell population there. There are some immature granulocytes here. If you can see, there's a small dark blue population there. So I'm just trying to tell you that it's not actually, they may contribute to, but they are not actually responsible for side fluorescence in all cases of these infections. So here's another case where there is, here it's very clear, there's a significant number of immature granulocytes and neutrophils, and the side fluorescence is increased, okay? So if it is not the immature granulocytes, then what is it that is responsible for the increase in side fluorescence in these cases? That is the question we needed to answer. So you look at the always when in doubt, go back to morphology. You look at the peripheral smear. On a Romanowski stain smear, this is what you see. What we would normally call a toxic neutrophil with its toxic granulations. And so here what you see is, apart from that, you do also find these bluish specks here and there, which are the Dolly bodies. Now Dolly bodies are nothing but clumps of mRNA, okay? They are just mRNA seen in the immature forms. And so they are seen in the neutrophils here, and the granularity is increased because they are persisting primary granules. So this is responsible for increase in side fluorescence. So we'll explain this in a little bit as well. So okay, you find okay similar kind of cells, okay, toxic changes, Dolly bodies. Here it's not in Dolly bodies, but you can see the blueness of the cytoplasm, which means there is a diffuse increase in RNA, which is again responsible for the increase in the side fluorescence. An immature cell, okay, with again lot of RNA in the cytoplasm, the bluishness attributes to that. So you find that in these cases, the normal side fluorescence, you find an increase in side fluorescence for the same reasons held. Now I'm just going back to the Coulter, okay, VCS technology, Beckman-Coulter principle, impedance and so on, where we know that in a case of sepsis, infection, inflammation, anything, there is an increase in the neutrophil volume, size is increased, right? So when the mean is around here, you can find 130 to 150, you find that, okay, population is increased, volume is increased. So what happens in these neutrophils? Now, what happens is when the cell comes from the marrow environment to the peripheral blood, what happens? Now the process of myelopoiesis from the blast to the mature neutrophil takes place, say, over a period of around 7 days. There are a lot of changes happening, from changes in the nucleus, changes in the cytoplasm. Both need to mature. So what happens, what we do know is that the nucleus matures, shape changes, chromatin becomes from an open, the it becomes the heterochromatin, okay, the changes from euchromatin and heterochromatin. Cytoplasm, initially it was larger, they shrink down. What happens, why the immature cells have more cytoplasm? Because they are replicating cells, they have more RNA, they are more blue, right? And then the size shrinks down when the cell matures. The primary azurophilic granules are replaced by the secondary granules. Now, is there actually a replacement of granules? No. It is only a staining property on the Romanowski stain smears. Now, what happens is that the primary granules have sialic acid residues, which are stained by a Romanowski dye. But when the cell matures, the sialic acid residues are lost. Therefore, the same Romanowski dye fails to stain that cell. So, which is why the granularity is seen much prominent or seen very prominently in the immature forms up to myelocyte stage, and then as it matures, you hardly find that. So what happens when there is a stress on the marrow, say infection, inflammation, sepsis? This takes place over 7 days, right? Now it is needed like right now. So what happens over 7 days probably happens over 2 days, maybe 1 day, maybe a few hours. So the maturation is like fast tracked. So what happens? Nucleus matures in whatever way it's possible, but the cell retains its immature cytoplasm, therefore it appears larger. And similarly, what else? The cytoplasm immature is, cytoplasm is also immature in terms of RNA, its nucleic acid content, okay? The azurophilic granules are not converted from primary to secondary, the sialic acid residues are retained, and therefore they take up the stain more, which is what we see as toxic granules. They are actually the persisting primary granules. So basically, as I mentioned, what we see when this time period of requirement of neutrophils is shortened, when it does not mature normally, it has to mature at a faster rate, toxic changes in terms of immature granules, Dolly bodies, neutrophil macrocytosis, okay, for the reasons mentioned. Right. So in sepsis, again, okay, so this is a case of leukocytosis. In fact, neutrophilic leukocytosis, same thing, okay, you have an increase in the neutrophil volume. And we'll also see here side fluorescence is increased. We'll also see some other cases. This we have mentioned why it happens, the mechanism is known. I'll just show you some other cases of sepsis where you can see. Okay, a case of enterococcal sepsis, side fluorescence is high, in fact almost double here. Aspiration pneumonia with a procal of 11.9, again SFL is high. Candida post-transplant, high SFL. Pseudomonas pneumonia, high SFL, all right. And coming back to our dengue, we told you what happens in the case of dengue. Now dengue with secondary sepsis, so apart from HFLC, this parameter also comes into play. Okay, you have your secondary sepsis, so you find your increase in the side fluorescence of the neutrophil. No, 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 1.4, 0.96 normal, 1.4. So then the other thing, now we know one critical part of dengue treatment is the platelets, right? That is the main part where people get worried, should we transfuse, should we not transfuse, will he bleed, will he not bleed, is he going into hemorrhagic fever, will he not go? So we try to look if we could incorporate the platelets into the study and see if there is any correlation with the parameters that we saw. So we had this with us already, the HFLC with the days, at presentation. We also looked at the platelet count on the same days of presentation. And this is what we found, something what we thought was pretty interesting. You can find that they're almost a mirror image of each other. When the HFLC shows a peak at day 5, the platelet counts shows a trough on day 5 infection. HFLC starts dropping, platelet count starts going up again. Right, so this is what we found in this particular study. I'll give you a scenario here, what we call a close to death scenario. It's about a 17-year-old male who was a student of IIT Madras and was proven to be dengue serology positive and was admitted in the ICU. It's a preventive admission. The boy was absolutely fine except that he is a known case of dengue with fever. Now this boy also happened to be the son of our ICU in charge. Okay, but that particular doctor was not there in station, he was away on sabbatical leave. And so this patient was managed by others there, and he was the person on the lab, Dr. Sukesh was in charge on the lab side, and this boy's father used to call over phone to Dr. Sukesh and find out what's happening. So at admission he was fine, the boy was walking around, he was fine, platelet count was 75,000. But what happened over the next couple of days is the platelet kept dropping. It went to 50, it went to 20, finally reached 6,000. So the boy's father, our ICU in charge, calls up Dr. Sukesh, do we need to transfuse? The boy was still fine, but do we need to transfuse? So I think we'll wait, let's see what happens. I mean, if he's not bleeding, if he's fine, we should not. We follow a very restrictive approach. If possible, avoid transfusion. And if necessary, give it, but if possible, avoid. And especially in this case, you know, especially being platelets, you know, platelets with its allosensitization, infection, refractoriness at a later point, all those issues taken. And this being this particular doctor's son, totally will wait. But then, next day, platelet count 1,000. So boy's father calls her frantically. Boy still fine, okay. He has just fever and he's admitted just prophylactic. He's walking around fine in the ICU. Calls up, do we need to transfuse? Yeah. Dr. Sukesh, now it's a little worrying, 1,000 platelets. He told, I'll get back to you, let me analyze the data on the counters, let me see the peripheral smear and I'll get back to you. So what he saw, so this is over the days what happened on the peripheral smear. Okay, initial date was something like this, a few platelets here and there. Then the numbers are going down, platelets appearing a little larger, bluer, something like this. And the last time he saw platelets was something like this. He told the doctor, the boy's father, that I think I'll hold on to transfusion. We'll withhold for now. The boy is still fine, we'll withhold for now. The boy's father was convinced, he said fine. The boy was also absolutely fine in the ICU, so everything was okay. So the boy, I'm sure he slept fine that day. The boy's father was also convinced he was fine. One person who had a sleepless night that day was Dr. Sukesh. So what happened? The next day morning, early morning, 2 o'clock, he calls up a senior technician and says, go and get the boy sample, do a platelet count. He does a platelet count, the platelet count now is 25,000. So what has happened? What are we dealing with here? So basically I'm trying to say that the platelets with deep blue cytoplasm and rich in azurophilic granules, okay? These platelets that we saw that day. So this is what we probably call reticulated platelets, young platelets with some residual mRNA. Like we have your reticulocytes, your polychromatophilic red cells, they are the deep blue platelets, probably young platelets, okay? So this is one area I will show with pertaining to our study, but I'm sure the next speaker, Dr. Swati, will delve in detail into this part of the study. Of this particular parameter. Anyway, we saw these young platelets, which are probably the reticulated platelets, and so you have a dedicated channel, which is your platelet F, and it uses a specific dye called auxin, which measures anything beyond this cutoff as your immature platelet fraction. There are quite a few studies which try to tell us about the utility, because we need to know the recovery of platelets in a case of dengue. So study of utility of IPF in the platelet recovery in a case of dengue, and almost all these studies are from India. So they all have done different methodology, different studies, but what they all, most of them agree or concur with each other is that you can predict using IPF a case of recovery from dengue in a period of around 48 hours, okay, roughly around 48 hours. So that is good information, new information, but the question is on a clinical setting, can we actually wait 24, 48 hours to see if this patient and hold on to transfusion? Many cases may not be possible. So that was the biggest thing, and then we thought we'd look at parameters, if there's anything from the counters that we can actually pick out to help us with this. So we kept looking at these cases, and what we saw is that whenever the histogram shows a presence of large platelets, you find that the IPF is high, as we have seen here, okay, 38.3 is the IPF, you find this large platelets here. Okay, this is just platelet erythrocytosis, including some large platelets here and there. And basically, platelets also contain mRNA. About 9,000 transcripts are there. There are microRNA are there. All right. So again, probably the same case. So then we looked at cases where there is macrothrombocytopenia. There are quite a few cases. Because we were seeing that when there are large cases, IPF is always high. So we looked at some cases like that. So we looked at some case of asymptomatic constitutional macrothrombocytopenia. Yes. Whether you need to transfuse. Yes, that is a call to be made clinically. Even guidelines used to say 20, but now people have come, the transfusion threshold has come down to even 10, some even 5, even 5. But then again, when you have a coexisting scenario, in this case menstruation, probably depending on the bleed, you might have to go ahead with the transfusion. We are talking about when the patient has no bleed, then how much you can wait, there's a cutoff. But again, it varies from center to center and should be made, the call should be made clinically. IPF is a help, I'm sure ma'am will speak on that a little more in detail. So we were assessing these cases of asymptomatic, not asymptomatic, just one of the cases, we're looking at macrothrombocytopenia, large platelets and lower platelet count. And one good example is, we get a lot of these patients from the northeast parts of India and Bangladesh, okay? They are known to have this, it's Harris platelet syndrome, if you have read about it. So again, we looked in this patient, okay, and we have this pattern, the same pattern, you have an IPF of 39.4. They are absolutely asymptomatic, it's just a part of their genes, right? So IPF of 39.4, another example, Bernard-Soulier syndrome, okay, thrombocytopenia, large platelets, that's why very few platelets, but the same pattern, okay, large platelets are an IPF of 40.7. May-Hegglin anomaly, again, large platelets and neutrophil inclusions, same pattern, IPF 64. So what we kept seeing is whenever there are large platelets, you find an increased IPF and you see this pattern. Okay, here another from the northeast part. 16-year-old boy from Assam. Platelets of all sizes including large platelets. Platelet of IPF is high, 65. On the peripheral smear, can you see these platelets, how large they are? Okay, so this is the pattern we see. Right. So basically what we're trying to say, platelets, all platelets have RNA and which is responsible for the bluish tinge. So the larger the platelet, more the RNA, more RNA, blue platelets. So basically what we feel is that IPF is just telling you that there are large platelets. Okay. Are they truly immature? Don't know. Food for thought. Right. So large platelets, increased IPF. Yeah, same thing. So basically you can see it's a linear trend between the two. Okay. Side fluorescence, forward scatter. Forward scatter is telling you the size. Larger the size, more the fluorescence. Larger the size, more RNA, more fluorescence. Okay. Immature? Probably. Don't know. So this pattern, this trend is what we noted. So then we wanted to see, we were talking about any parameter to help us trace or predict the recovery of platelets. Okay. So then what another thing that we notice in all these cases, if you look at the correlate with the WNR channel. Okay, we looked at the WNR channel as well. And as you can see, when there are large platelets, and of course when you get this and when there is an IPF, you also find this population here, which is actually counted as debris or platelet comes actually, but we found that they're probably not debris or platelet, they're probably platelets, okay? So you find this here, when there is the same pattern, okay? Large platelets, IPF, and this one. IPF is 40, let's see more cases. Okay, a few cases, few cells, I mean platelets there, IPF of 30.3, this population here. Another case, hardly any large platelets, hardly any IPF, hardly any cells there, okay. Here, a few large platelets, IPF 12.2, a few cells there, and a few scattered cells here. This one is a case of essential thrombocytosis, okay, essential thrombocythemia, 8,27,000 platelet count. IPF is only 2.9. It might seem, there's nothing here, we know that. It might seem that there are some population cells, significant number here, but when you see, when this is in lakhs, we know that the density of the cells, the entire cell population actually falls here. And hardly, less than 3% is right up there. And it is this population again, which is reflected here, and you can see again that the density of the cells are here. Which means This population is probably reflected here, all right, and the IPF. So there's a correlation there. Again, another case, a few large platelets, IPF 24.5, and this population here like this. Again, I showed you about a 16-year-old boy from Assam. I showed you all this. Now I'll show you this one as well. Okay, IPF 65.3, and you can see this way goes up way there. And this case, cases like this are going to give you a what? A false high leukocyte count. Okay, it's encroaching right up there. Right. Okay, it's going to give you a count right up there. Okay, this case. So we found that basically your IPF or basically your RNA there is reflected. The platelets with increased RNA content are reflected on the WNR channel. So you could actually get a clue what's happening from this particular channel as well. So then the question, what are these? Okay, we have seen so many large platelets, then there are platelets like these. So blue, deep blue compared to your, say, Assamese patient, yeah, they are large platelets. Compare that, contrast that to this. What about this? Platelet like this. Or a platelet like this is a platelet. Platelet like this. What about all these? Now, if nothing was told, nothing was given, and just the slide was shown, probably I'll say it's macrocytic RBCs and a reactive lymphocyte. But no, it's a platelet. It's just this thing of a plate, a reactor. It's a platelet, okay? So what we feel is probably these are the true immature platelets, okay? These large platelets, deep blue cytoplasm, lot of RNA, these are the true immature platelets. So where do they fall on the platelet F channel? No. We don't even think there could be this. You see this. We don't think it could be even this. I think it should fall. We think it should fall somewhere here. Okay. This is scaling of the platelets, right? So if you can scale it down, probably you'll find them right up there. You can see this, okay? IPF 61.7, huge platelets there. The same thing reflecting in the WNR channel. Another case, okay? The other two cases, the platelets I showed you, these are the two corresponding to those, right? High IPF, large platelets. We think the immature platelet fraction would actually fall out of this. So that's again just food for thought from what we found out there. So basically what I'm trying to say is that cell counters are sensitive to even subtle changes in the peripheral blood, and research parameters like your HFLC percentage, your neutrophil side fluorescence, neutrophil forward scatter, side scatter could be useful in diagnosis of dengue and scrub typhus. Scattergram patterns, even in the absence of numerical data, can reliably interpret it and aid in the early diagnosis of certain fevers like the ones we discussed. And WNR channel is a good RNA staining channel and can reflect the IPF and help predict platelet recovery in dengue. So before concluding, I would just like to acknowledge certain people, Dr. Sukesh Nair in our lab, who is the driving force and the inspiration behind whatever happens there. Dr. Anand Vikas, he is the brilliance behind the dengue and scrub typhus study there, and Dr. Ashwati, who has done quite some work on the platelets as part of our MD thesis. So thank you all. Thank you all for your patience. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Niti. Our next speaker is Dr. Swati.
Platelets are falling far beyond.
The true immature platelets that look like this, yeah, and this.
I agree with you. Yeah. Perhaps that is true also. Would you think by adding flow cytometry to it on a separate platform, it might be able, you might be able to actually pick them up? Maybe using a dye and then seeing how they fall in terms of their fluorescence, because the fluorescence and the size of the flow cytometer would be almost parallel. So would that not help picking them up? I'm just putting the food for thought.
Yes. Sure. This is food for thought. As I was definitely. Yes. Possible.
So you're saying 41, 61
yeah,
in
put
one
it up there and then FS on the other.
That's it. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. I think a lot of what I'm going to present, the introduction has already been given by Niti. Is it echoing? Okay. So I would like to thank the organizers of APPI and TransAsia for getting me here. And I think this conference is a very good omen. Last year, I don't know how many of you attended, but that day, the day the conference began, the monsoons came. Same thing happened today. So I think your speakers and this conference is a good omen for you. So coming to the platelet indices, there was a lot of controversy when I sent my title. I kept saying IPF trumps, and they kept making it IPF triumphs. In the area of Hillary and Trump, I think IPF trumps. I hope Trump doesn't trump, that's all. So it is IPF trumps. Every time it went back and forth, and people asked me, do you want to say triumphs? I said, no, I want to say trumps because IPF trumps the other indices. So this is where we are nowadays with the XN giving you so much information, some research parameters, some reportable parameters. These are all the ones. How many of you are XN users except the speakers? Does anybody use the XN or high-ended five-part differential or seven-part differential? So if you see the screen, there is so much information coming out. Most of these research parameters of today will be reportable parameters of tomorrow. IPF itself was a research parameter. RET-HE was a research parameter. RDW several years ago was only a research parameter. So my questioning is that, okay, these will eventually become reportable, but do such, so much of platelet information, is it really of value? I don't know. We know for years and years that we cannot do without hematocrit, MCV, MCH, and MCHC. They are here to stay forever. But are these really, really important is something that I've been looking at ever since I got the XN. And maybe at the end of my talk, we will be convinced that maybe some of these parameters are really not of clinical use. So to just go briefly as to how these platelets are counted on the analyzers, in fact, all impedance-based analyzers have the same way of counting. You have the cells passing through an aperture. There are two electrodes, and there's a electrical impulse going along which the cell is passing from here. RBCs and platelets are going together. So that's where the challenges lie when we have problems with platelet counting. And this is how, through the aperture, when the RBC goes, based on its volume, it hits the electrode, impulses get counted. Platelet goes, going through the same channel, and based on the frequency distribution, curves are established. Now, I showed you a lot of information on the screen of an analyzer, but I think for every pathologist, it is important to look at the graphs and the curves that the machine is giving out. And that electrical impedance then gets fine-tuned by a hydrodynamic focusing. And samples which pass through the center, there's a sheath fluid here in a vacuum, which pass through the aperture. It gives you a higher accuracy because you don't have two cells going at the same time, you don't have clumps going at the same time, and you get a far more accurate count when there is a hydrodynamic focusing principle along with the electrical impedance. So what are the various platelet parameters, which is also called platelet volume indices? In fact, the better terminology, scientific terminology, is to call them platelet volume indices. We have the platelet count impedance, which is the commonest way of counting platelets, optical, which used to be given in the XE system earlier, and fluorescent, which we are currently using now, mean platelet volume, platelet distribution width, platelet crit, which is like hematocrit, platelet large cell ratio, reticulated platelet or IPF. The Siemens machine also gives something called mean platelet component. They're using its use in platelet function assays because it is based on a principle of degranulation of the platelet. So whether that parameter can be used as a indicator of a platelet function, but this is all just new now. We will stick to these because obviously we are talking on an XN platform and I don't have information on much information on mean platelet component. So the platelet volume indices we know are indicative of changes in platelet function. The size we just discussed may not be related to immaturity, but it is related to activity for sure. Activity how? Because studies have shown that they have a higher aggregation function. They have a higher expression of the platelet receptors, which is GP1B and 2B, 3A receptors. So we know that the younger platelets are the more active. We also know that all the indices together show that the activity of the platelets. To clear the controversy on the normal platelet count, it is accepted now that the upper range is 4 lakhs. Primarily because the definition of essential thrombocytosis came back, the thrombocythemia came as 4.5. Earlier it was 6 lakhs in the earlier WHO. The newer WHO called it 4.5, so we had to have a buffer. So 4 lakh is now the upper range of a normal platelet count. And this is how the normal platelet histogram looks. All good pathologists look at the RBC histogram, but it is worth looking at the platelet histogram. Because the platelet, if you see this graph here, we have two discriminators which are fixed, which are floating discriminators, the lower and the upper, which are fixed on the size, which size is again in femtoliters just like the RBC. The lower one is fixed at 2, upper one is fixed at 30, and here at 12 there is a fixed discriminator. So by and large, the platelets will fall in this plot here and they are all counted here. This is how you get the platelet histogram. So this is how a normal histogram should be. It is worth keeping this in mind because I will show you cases when this will overlap with this and how you have some erroneous reports because of this floating upper discriminator. So what is a platelet distribution width? It is just like the red cell distribution width, not of much clinical use like the RDW. RDW, you know, you do need it for iron deficiency and thalassemia trait differentiation. PDW, we do not know much about its value. We know that it is just an indicator of the anisocytosis of platelets. The normal range of PDW is 9 to 14 femtoliters. And this is how the PDW gets counted here. It is measured at 20% of the relative height. If the total curve you take as 100%, so you know that the distribution, most of the platelets should fall here. And this is how the reference range is derived. Platelet crit, again, like hematocrit, I do not know the clinical significance. In fact, nobody knows really the significance of platelet crit, but it is a sum of the platelet impulses which are eventually detected by the impedance analyzer, analogous to the PCV. And this is the platelet, so this is how you get the platelet crit, again, like the hematocrit, 0.6 to 0.38. Platelet large cell ratio is a percentage of large platelets. I said there was a floating discriminator and a fixed. So beyond 12 femtoliters where you get here, this is in the graph, these are all the platelet large cell ratio. Again, we do not know whether it's giving us too much information. So the point I'm trying to make is all those parameters which are reported parameters, when you refine your machines, should they really be reported? Because do they really give us much value? And we'll see whether they do in the cases to come. Amongst all these parameters, MPV was so far the best studied. It is a mean platelet volume between the lower and the upper discriminator. It's a calculated parameter, dividing the platelet crit by the total number of platelets. Reference range of value in most studies, reference values were 7 to 12 femtoliters. Now we have a lot of technical issues because this can vary from machine to machine. And so whether we really have a true reference range for MPV or any of the platelet indices, it's really not well accepted because you have to see it on various analyzers. Anticoagulant type is important. If you see the MPV on a citrate sample, MPV on an EDTA sample, EDTA causes swelling of the platelets, it may differ. Time from sampling, and that is why MPV, whether it has much clinical use is to be seen because MPV is very dependent. And MPV will change between 4 hours of sampling and between 12 hours of sampling. So there are certain technical issues as to why we could not really standardize the reference ranges of all these indices. So if you have a case like this, a platelet count of 24,000, This is not run in the platelet F mode, but platelet count of 24,000 and the machine giving a flag of thrombocytopenia and platelet clumps, and this graph, which is not smooth, we have to make a slide. You're going to check because you have a low platelet count, you have a flag saying clumps or thrombocytopenia and an irregular graph. So first thing we look for, is there a clot in the sample? That is by default, if the technician will look at it first. And then whether there is pseudothrombocytopenia. Pseudothrombocytopenia, okay, you know, this is platelet satellitism. Another case with low platelet, again platelet clumps, bad graph. You can get a huge clump like this. So once you have ruled out that there is no technical issue, there is no clot, there is no clumping like this, then we proceed with the other causes of thrombocytopenia. So earlier this was in the XE machine, we don't see platelet O now. When you have a platelet count of 60,000, an optical platelet, so this was in the earlier XE, when you run the retic reagent, platelet O was giving you a count when you were doing it in the retic mode. And see the difference between optical and impedance. Impedance was giving us 60,000, optical was giving us 140,000, and there were these large platelets, as Niti mentioned, in asymptomatic constitutional macrothrombocytopenia. I'm going to talk a lot about that later. But so this was the advantage when we added another parameter called platelet O. But at that time, you had to run it. So if you ran the retic reagent and ran all your samples in the retic mode, only then we would get a platelet O. So after using XE, when we came to XN, we saw the benefit that to give us an IPF and a platelet F was far more useful than the running platelet O in the earlier machines. So this, using the XE and XN, we saw that there were three different kinds of platelet counting: impedance, which was most common, optical, which was being done in the when you ran it in the retic mode, and this committed channel, which now we have on XN, showing platelet F, which is the platelet count based on fluorescence flow cytometry. So the platelet F channel was also counting the reticulated or immature platelet. Reticulated platelets counted on a different platform, it's called reticulated. In this machine, we call it platelet F or immature platelets, which are newly released platelets, which is just like a reticulocyte count in an erythrocyte. And it gives you an indicator of thrombopoiesis. It increases when the platelet production rises, decreases when there is a decreased activity. There have been studies, so the guidelines say that the most accurate way of counting platelets is immunological, but it's very expensive to do 4161 on cases, on all cases. So various studies before the XN came showed that correlation was very good with the platelet F and 61 as compared to platelet I and optical. And other studies subsequently from 2006, there were a lot of studies showing that immature platelet fraction, I mean just when they started using it, was a better indicator of thrombopoiesis or showing response to treatment.
Dysfunction thrombosis. This is one of the earlier studies showing a correlation between IPF versus MPVS and platelet acid ratio. Again, other studies showing that IPF impedes thrombocytopenia. This was one of the earlier articles again in 2006 showing that IPF can be used to measure the requirement of transfusion in stem cell therapy. This is Kunal's paper which came out in International Journal of Plasmatology showing it as a predictor of dengue epidemic recovery. So once we saw all this, that more and more studies were coming out, we also decided. But till then we had no XN. Once we saw that XN had a value, in 2013 we got both our XNs. And then we started doing part work on platelet F and IPF, because by then it was well established that IPF is a marker of thrombopoietic activity. It is useful in diagnosis of thrombocytopenia, and platelet F was far more precise because in the platelet O that we were doing earlier, there was a lot of interference in DIC cases, in cases which had a lot of fragmented RBC, in thalassemia cases. So we knew that platelet O unfortunately did not help us too much. So then when we moved on, and I say something bad because XE does not exist now. We also studied the pseudo school. So don't feel bad when I say it. I saw Archana smiling. That over really didn't help us. So just like the dengue, I presented and the award was for the pseudo basophilia, but now because of machine is more refined, it doesn't give us that value. So then we move down to the platelet. Of course, when you add a parameter, there is an extra cost. So there is a new reagent now. There it was a genetic reagent for platelet. Now it is a fluorescent. And there are two, that small pouch and this. But it is useful, as I will show you. So what happens in the platelet F channel? This is a separate channel and a separate cell pack and a fluorescent platelet. So you are adding two extra reagents. The cell pack causes perforation of the cell membrane to facilitate the entry of the dye. And this dye, this fluorescent platelet, which is a proprietary dye, it stains the platelets both from inside and outside very strongly. And does not, it enters the RBCs, but not as strong as the platelet. So there is no interference like the platelet O in the platelet F. And so the platelet F channel is a separate channel. In the same volume that you are, it's aspirating, it is giving you an extended count. So it is a prolonged count. It is counting far more platelets than platelet I and platelet O is counting. And when you have both the channels available, there's a reflex testing. So it takes whether I is more reliable or F, and it gives you the platelet F value, and it's directly comparable to immunological studies. So like I said earlier, we used to have problems like this also at platelet O when there was a lot of interference, and it used to give a very high count. So interference would say to me like 30,000, O would be around 150, which is not possible. But in these cases of thal or sickle or any hemoglobinopathy, there was a lot of interference with the RBC in the platelet O channel, which is not there in platelet F. Again, to show you the advantages, I'm putting this up because we moved on. We, from the SF series to the XE, for several years we had XE. Now for the last 3 years I'm using X, and I can see the difference between all these counts. So when we started our study, when we started platelet F, we said first let us develop our own reference range. Kunal had already put up the reference range, it was published, but we said, okay, we will establish our own reference range. So where do you get samples from when you are establishing a reference range? Either you collect your staffs, but here we needed 150 samples. So we collected from the health check patients. We started collecting from health check, and every day, so in our, it's a 650 bed hospital. We have around 670 to 80 health check. We thought we finished the study in 1 week, culture had also come, and we were going to standardize. Every day the data was going haywire. So this highest thing did not strike me at that time because we also have a lot of Bengalis coming. And when you, in our system, we don't see the name, right? We just get hospital number. So every day we would sit down and see the analysis of platelet F, and it was going like from 2% to 40, 2% to 30 in the cases at 40 or 50 cases studied. And we said something is not right. And nobody bothers, we are three pathologists who are doing only hematology, but we don't sit and see health checks, like that's not an importance. You come in the morning, first you clear the ICU, you clear the transplant health check after 9 o'clock. And we started seeing all the slides, because we thought, see, to get this working, you have to, and to justify that you're going to ask for platelet F and DFL, which costs money, you have to prove to the management, at least in my hospital, that you are adding a parameter which is of use. You cannot just, I'm not going to discuss cost, but add a new test and say, I'm going to now start doing this because you're going to put your index is going to increase. Then we started looking at the slides, which was a headache. But if you see here, platelet F count is coming 114. So 114,000 platelet in a normal health check patient. And look at the graph here and screen platelet at a normal distribution. And IPF very high. Till then, Kunal had said IPF around 7 is what the Bombay group had published. And this is the kind of platelet. And this is my case, because if you see this target, it will give you an indication. This is a typical Bengali, from West Bengal patient, which has a thyroid trait, and look at his large, very, very large plate. It's almost like the size of a lymphocyte. So we realized that this is the population which was skewing our data. Now, Bangalore being what it is, a lot of Bengalis come, especially parents. So there are a lot of these software guys who get their parents to our hospital. And every day I see around 7 or 8 patients from West Bengal in our health check. Then we decided now that we will make our own local population. So now in any big city there is nothing for local population. If you ask me in Karnataka, what is my local population? It is Telugu, Tamil, and Kannadigas. So there is no ethnic kind of thing in the younger population that I am deriving. So we thought we will exclude them by name. If you see my name, I am not from Bangalore, right? If you see Swati Pai, you say, okay, you are from. So we could not even get them by name, we had to question them. I am from UP, by name you will never figure I am from UP. So then we went to health check and said, okay, we want to know somebody who is a Bengali and Bengali, not a Roy, somebody who is married, a Bhatti who is married to a Roy. And it was very difficult to get. So we then categorized our patients as normal patients who were born, both parents were Bengalis, born in West Bengal or born wherever, but out of two Bengali parents, with normal platelet count. And you'll be surprised because we got normal platelet count Bengalis only 50 and ones with a load with asymptomatic constitutional microthrombocytopenia 77 in our check, which was far more than the normal. And we didn't call them the local population of Karnataka, we just said normal patients with normal platelet counts, nothing to do with West Bengal. I mean, neither Tamilians, Telugu or Kannadians. And then we derived our reference range and we got our own reference range as 0.7 to 9.1. The population from Bengal we got is 9.1 to 29.9, the mean IPF of 9.9. And the patients who had a low platelet count, and the cutoff we took as around 197 paper, we got a very high IPF. See the median, 25.5 and then and 8 to 47.1 was our reference range. So then we had to categorize like this. Now limiting, okay, so then first we presented this as a poster in the International Society of Lab Hematology in Chicago last year. And we had lots and lots of comments on this poster when we tried to publish it. It was not so easy. And so then we, looking at the Bengalis, again we had to put them as, divide them into platelet counts from 125 to 100 to 75 to see what was the mean IPF they were getting. And then this then finally got published in the International Journal of Lab Hematology. Recently it was for me, and this recent issue has come out with this in the index. So our first job was first to establish the reference range, and then what we started doing is writing a disclaimer that this is the reference range that we have established. So the whole purpose of doing this study was that when these patients came from health check with low platelet count, they were getting referred to hematology. Like he mentioned, there's a lot of ITP. That summarizes my talk actually. You said there's a lot of ITP in Northeast. So it is not ITP. This is what they were all about. And in centers like Vellore and Ames and all where they are there, we are all aware of it. I was never aware of it because until I came to this hospital, and we had a very famous cardiologist called Dr. Devi Shetty who moved from Calcutta. So when Devi Shetty moved, the whole Calcutta started coming to us for heart surgeries. And before the heart surgeries, we were getting new patients and we didn't know to give them fitness or not. This was in 99 and till then I didn't know this existed. When I called Sukesh, he said, oh, we know, we have only published it from our blood bank data called Harris's syndrome. But to justify to a surgeon, it's very difficult. Can I do surgery? Can I not do surgery? Then if the surgeon would, then the anesthetist will see the count and the anesthetist will refuse. So we have started giving our reference ranges, we quote our paper and say that we will not change because between the three of us, my colleagues and I, one of my colleagues is from the US and she does not believe in giving this manual count at all. Like how we change 20,000 multiplier. So she said, I'm not going to change. So then we have decided we will give the Bengali patient the low platelet count, say 110, give his IPF and quote our study and say, okay, it's good for surgery or for lap poly or whatever. So this was the major task that we had to standardize our reference range and to standardize and to put get a reference range for the Bengalis. Of course, it's a smaller, we could not get so many. This went on for 1 year because even for the paper they said, to have any reference range, you must have a place control study of at least 150 patients. We could not get so many. So this is was our first step. And then this was the Chicago paper then which got published. Then after having this, we justified that, okay, we are going to start doing platelet F and IPF for all patients. Then we started looking at patients, not at normal. And of course, as Niti has already presented, it is of great value. I will just show you one case. This is an elderly male with diabetes who was in an outside hospital, had dengue. I don't know why they kept saying it is only mild positive. I don't know whether this zither cutoff or Dhiggar cutoff has any value. He was IgG positive, reactive, NS1 negative, IgG of course negative, very mildly altered NFP. And he had no access to IPF for a long time because he was in outside hospital. He got transferred to our hospital last year around this time, 28th of May. And he had an IPF of a low, very low platelet. He kept maintaining 20, 20, 50. IPF of very high IPF of 16 to 18. And the question, this is not with hematology. This patient is with general physician who said, I cannot give him steroids because he has diabetes. I don't want to transfuse him. You tell me what should I do because you are sad. We charge for IPF. So if you are charging him, I want to know what is the value. Will it help? I want to give him a transfusion. All I will do is marrow, he could be your NDS. So we kept telling him that you wait 2 days, they did an IPF. Then one day the IPF was low. We got only 8. And he said, now I'm going to stop sending IPF, it has no value. I'm going to send this patient home. Because this patient was in a bad shape, the relatives didn't take him home. After 6 days, again, they sent the IPF, which was high, and then the platelet recovered. So this was our challenge. We had already sent circulars to the hematologist, to other, but this was a young general physician who didn't want to send any IPF. He didn't believe. He sent on 2 days. Third day when it fell, he said, I'm not going to send it because it has no value. And we kept saying that they will, the platelets will recover because IPF is high, and finally his platelets was shot up and he was discharged at around 1 lakh. Then we started doing studies on other cases. So this is a child with pancytopenia, low platelet, and IPF of only 2. We know when the marrow is suppressed, there is going to be no activity. If you did a bone marrow, this was an aplastic anemia. If you see the graph that you have shown earlier, hardly an image of platelets. So case of aplastic anemia. This is a case which Kanchan shared with me. A known case of AML was on chemotherapy. Platelet F is very low. IPF is 9.5, but this patient, then you see her recovery, platelet comes up later after 5 days to 25, IPF is come down low, does not recover more after that. This is an AML on chemotherapy, has some recovery, but after the IPF is tap on 2.7, there is hardly any recovery. You see hardly any image of patients, you can't see anything. So this is our patient who studies in a hospital engineering college near my hospital, who is called Dengue. And this is his platelet count. He had Dengue and sepsis. You see his count is really high. Patient count is 24,000, IPF 27.3. So this is just like the case which was discussed earlier. At this time we said no, there is no need to panic, his platelets will recover, and they did recover. So once we saw the first poster that we presented was only to differentiate between the Northeast population and the local population. This was a poster which was presented in the American Society of Clinical Pathology, seeing all our cases. So IPF utility in all the patients, whether it was of any use. And the study basically just corroborated what happened in the studies which was published earlier, that it did have utility in severe illnesses. It did have utility to differentiate between normal and abnormal, the clinically significant low platelets and not significant low platelets. This was presented in Long Beach, California last year by my colleague Tikabar. So we had 2 studies on IPF. Even then, some of our old clinicians were not very impressed. They said, you use MPD. Why do you want the patient to pay for IPF? You use MPD as a clinical indicator because in our times, MPD was of more. So then I said, okay, let me review what, because I have not done any studies on MPD as a parameter, mainly because I had this new tool and I was looking at it and I found it more useful and I was dealing with reference ranges that I had established. So I just reviewed the literature on what is the usefulness of MPD compared to IPF. So this is a study, these are all studies from Europe or the US. This is a study, last study, which compared patients of ITP, a thrombocytopenia due to ITP and thrombocytopenia due to any other disorder of production. There are only 28 genuine cases of ITP and 128 of all other thrombocytopenias. And they found that if you use a cutoff of MPD 8.3 or 9.4, 8.3 in ITP, 9.4 in the other thrombocytopenias, they had a good sensitivity but not a great specificity for the disease. Another study which had 473 patients of all types of thrombocytopenia using a cutoff of 10.5,
value of 95 in a, an NPV of 10.5 was taken as cutoff, and a low NPV had a positive predictive value of 77. Nothing giving you any great thing because it was not diagnosing what type of thrombocytopenia. Another study with 699 cases of all different types of thrombocytopenia showed that a low NPV just had some negative and positive predictive value almost the same. Again, the similar thing. In megaro and non-megaloblastic marrows, a study which showed all types of, which studied all types of pancytopenia. They had 88 cases of megaloblastic, 180 cases of non-megaloblastic anemias, pancytopenias. They showed that an NPV cutoff of 7.45 had a specificity and sensitivity of around 67%. So the reason I'm showing you all these were the NPV cutoffs are ranging from 7.45 to 9.5, which is a wide range in various studies, and none of these studies have established their own range for their own population. Again, NPV ITP versus chemo, this study takes 9 as cutoff and shows a very good sensitivity, you know, but if this had taken the previous cutoff at 7.45, maybe the results would have been different. Then came a lot of papers on the use of NPV and cardiac disease. So our people start, so the, when we sent our paper for publication, a lot of people said, did you study this IPF correlation with cardiac activity? So we said, I mean cardiac diseases. We said, we are still on the first piece, we are trying to standardize and get a reference range right first. To study cardiac disease prospectively is not easy because when a patient comes with acute MI or something, it's not the first test that is sent at all. In our emergency, CBC is not ordered at all till the patient reaches a bed. They do the profile, they do everything, they take them to ECG echo. Nobody is drawing any DTA in the first place. So we again reviewed literature and saw that a large study showed patients who came with chest pain and then finally they really had MI. NPV cutoff of 9 taken to show much of a positive predictive value, had a negative predictive value. But this is also retrospective study. Again, this is ST elevation myocardial infarction patient study. This is patients who had an IMPV, and then they saw that after they were doing angio, there was no flow in some vessel or the other, had this much of a sensitivity and specificity. Other diseases, to see whether antiplatelet treatment had any benefit, looking at MPV was plus minus. Studies are unequivocal saying that we don't know whether MPV, a high MPV correlates with the, whether they should be put on aspirin. Or does a high NPV generate a group of patients which require more aggressive treatment than aspirin? No data to show that. Again, high NPV has been shown to be associated with gestational diabetes. High NPV again with preeclampsia. Again, all retrospective studies. Doesn't show that if a woman has a high NPV, she is going to have gestational diabetes. This paper we saw yesterday, which has come in the latest issue. It shows association of mean platelet volume and platelet count with development of ischemic or hemorrhagic strokes. Does the excess count IPA? I don't know. Excess 2009, because this is a study from China, which does not count IPA. So they have used only MPV. I think if they had IPF and they had done their own study, no, I don't think excess 2009 or this, because the study started in 2011 and concluded in 2012. And it was said, so, and in this study I saw, did they make their own range of NPV? No, they have taken, China is a vast country, they have taken a range of NPV for Chinese population published elsewhere. So I think when you have access to your data and your own reference range, things could change. So they took NPV of 13 and showed that there was some change in the development of the stroke. So these are all patients who presented to their casualty with stroke. They showed that it had a correlation with the progress of how they would develop, their outcome would be. These are not patients who initially began with a high NPV. So we now, looking at IPF data, we feel that maybe, I mean, it's not, it's written in literature, may a limiting percentage, maybe an absolute IPF count reflects a real type platelet count. So in future, whether an absolute IPF would benefit more than IPF percentage, this is something that we have to see. It may have potential because in treating other diseases or diagnosis of other disease like chronic liver disease, in DM, this of course has now been well documented that in hemodialysis the patient platelet kinetics changes. IPF is a very useful tool in patients who are undergoing dialysis for CRF. And in predicting sepsis, these are all something that maybe we can do in future. Now, like back to my graph that I was showing, is that by whatever I have shown now, we get tangled in the IPF is fantastic. Platelet depth is fantastic. But everything, nothing can replace your eyes and your brain, because there will be cases like these which will, have a bouncer thrown at you, and then you have to deal with it. This is an 18-year-old female with severe pallor. She has hemoglobin of 7.5. Very, very low indices, RBC indices, BCD27, MCD49. Even if she has severe iron deficiency, she cannot have a reactive thrombocytosis giving a platelet of 26 lakhs. Not possible. You see the flags here, say iron deficiency thrombocytosis, and see this here. This is done in platelet heart. Severe iron deficiency. Small, small, small platelets which are merging. I told you that the platelets, the larger platelets go into RBC channel, but the smaller RBCs also fall in the platelet channel. That is a false count of 26,000. Another patient here is giving you in platelet depth 3,12,000. Again, very, very low indices. IPF of only 3.3 platelet counts. So see this graph. This is RBC graph. And this is serocytes and NRBCs which are merging, which is giving a false count. So, when I asked Kanchan that case, it's giving you a normal count of 3,12,000, but it's not a real count. So, she said, it's still giving you a flag. So, even if you have a normal count, and it's giving you that asterisk star there, you have to review the smear. Another case here, 22 lakh platelet count, no indices. Diagnostic population, it's saying here are two peaks, I'm not going to RBC graphs, so two peaks in the RBC, it shows that there's a diagnostic population. Thrombocytosis, the entire platelet graph is shifted. This is a false platelet count. And this is our most recent case which came some time back. With all this medical tourism and all, we have patients coming a lot from Africa. So this guy is a known case of CA Lung who comes from Nigeria. He was with us for the first chemotherapy. Went back, followed up after 3 more cycles. He came back with a casualty. And he's got a very funny name, his name is Mr. Macaque something something. So Macaque is a species of a monkey. So we know. So somebody said Macaque is back in the emergency. And they are very nice, friendly people. They chat. So we said, why is he in emergency? He should be going to oncology. The oncology goes directly to oncology, not to the ER. He's come with fever. And he has a low platelet count. So even if it is chemotherapy based on something older, his platelet count doesn't fall so high. So low, 22,000. We said, okay, we'll examine his smear. His platelet F the same time has come 194. Now, so this is on XN1, in which we don't run the platelet F. We have an XN, the second XN. The one we run, this is at 2A. So this is a platelet I, which came 22,000, shows thrombocytopenia. And this is platelet F, which shows 194. Till then, we have not made this smear. IPF is 70%. And you see this, that means what he has all image of platelets, but why? I mean, his chemo doesn't cause so much of suppression. By that time, his slide was made and there was much excitement in our lab. Every RBC almost has malaria. Okay. So this is, in this case, his platelet I was more accurate, not his F, because malaria is causing high fluorescence. And this is okay at Farsukar. I have not seen so much of every slide. In fact, before we saw the demand, we thought this is not going to be falsified. Because so much of, so we also got very smart, we sent it for images, it got rejected from everywhere. I think this is just downright falsified.
Is he still alive?
No, he's alive. He's alive. So that's why, we didn't want to send.
100%.
Yeah. And, but we sent this for Ash and British Health Africa, everywhere images, they said, no, this is very known. Because we have never seen like this kind of, what form would I call it outside, so this was, this can, so the only carrot I've seen in platelet F is interference with malarial pigment. And that's my last slide. So platelet F and IPF is here to stay. Why I say it trumps is because I think it has more value with NPD.
if we do prospective studies. Everybody is using, going back and saying, okay, so much of stroke, looking at the NCD in hindsight. If we do prospective studies, we have finished on ACMG, we have finished on peptide analysis. I think my next topic, if I am invited, you know, will be on cardiac disease in IPF, I don't know. Thank you, Dr.
So my role now is to talk to you about slide review criteria, and I have specially named it as slide review criteria in the era of automated release of reports. Now the first question which I'll ask all of you is, how many of you see all your slides? 1, 2, 3, 4. Almost all are seeing all slides.
You work in solid.
So you have a 3-part or a 5-part?
3-part.
So if there's a 3-part, you'll have to see, you have no choice. But if you have a 5-part, why would you want to see all your slides? Okay? So what I'm going to talk about is, this is the hospital where I work in Delhi. And the thing is, where did it all start? It started way back in November 2013, we had an audit in our hospital, NABN. And Dr. Sukesh came by as a SSF for hematology. And he asked one of our technical staff, do you see all your smears? Says, no. So how many smears do you see? Maybe about 30% or 50%. How do you know which smear to see? So says, sir tells us. So I tell them what to see and what not to see. So that's how the whole story started, and he gave us a non-conformity which we closed down. And when we closed down the non-conformity, this came out, that's the presentation, and that's what you're seeing today. Okay, so the question is, how do we actually go about looking at the slide review criteria? So the thing is that if you have a printout like this coming from an analyzer, and this is what you see, a hemoglobin of 6 grams, low MCV, MCH, IRDW, and the platelets near normal. Right? What are you expecting in this case? A microcytic hypochromic red cell picture, right? And therefore you would definitely want to see a blood flow. Now, if you have a case like this, you have a hemoglobin of 15 grams, normal MCV, normal MCM, normal RUW, normal platelets, and nothing abnormal on the printout at all. No flagging at all. Now do you want to see a smear? No, you wouldn't. There's no need. Because the analyzer has actually seen everything very nicely, beautifully, and you really need not now waste time on just re-looking at the smear and reconfirming what's already come. In the other case, you would want to see because you want to know what's the type of anemia. You find anything more than what you're seeing on the analyzer itself. So therefore, this decision, how does one decide to review or not to review, is something which one has to get into their mind. So obviously, there will be rules, there will be decisions which will be made on certain rules as to how you will see a smear. And invariably, when you ask how you will get the rules is, there are a lot of things which will govern it. The first thing, what is the burden? Burden not only in terms of the money, we're basically talking about the amount of load that you see per day. What's the cost involved? What's your turnaround time? And how precise and accurate are you when you are actually depending on those rules to give out the slide to you? So let's look at what our workload is at our hospital where I work. We classify labs into small and medium size and large size labs based on the way the NABL has given. So if you have less than 100 CBC samples a day, 100 samples a day, you fall into a small lab category. Anything between 100 to 400 is about medium size, and more than 500 is large. We get classified somewhere into medium sized lab. So in a medium sized lab, in our lab, we have about 400 samples a day in 24 hours, and we have other things also happening at the same time. And there's a concept of authorized signatories in the NABL, right? So only some people are allowed to report it out. So we have two of them, 8 to 6, and one registrar on shift duties, right? So 400 reports, 24 hours, while you have a lot of other things happening within the lab, and a lot of things which people want you to do there and then at that point in time. So you need to depend on the data review. You might need to review all the rules. You need to see the normal ranges, look at the critical values, any data checks which are there in that particular patient, any dilutional needs, any manual processes that you might need to do, and all these things you need to look at when you are doing a sample review from a patient. How does everyone know the rules? I asked you, this question was asked by the assessor as well, how do you know the rules? So you were, interestingly, you are actually expected to answer that you have it in the procedural manuals. But invariably, when you actually do a reality check, what really happens? Most of them say, we know it because it's in our memory, right? And otherwise, some people say, oh, it's lying on there, it's like in the, on the shelf there. That's how they talk about it. But what is important is, it has to be a procedure manual, and somebody has to know how to look into it. So let's look at the average workload that we are talking about, 400 CVCs. If we make all 400 smears, 4 authorized signatories were available, 8 hours of each of them, total available hours you have 32 hours. And we are assuming we are not having lunch. Time spent on each slide is about 10 minutes, right? Ideal. I know most of us don't do that. But let's assume that we are ideal pathologists and we'd spend 10 minutes on every smear. So what you need is about 400 minutes. That makes it about 67 hours. And you had only 32. So you have a deficit of 35 hours. You'll never be able to do justice to the work that you're expected to do. So therefore, you need to ensure that your manual review is as minimal as possible. You have to ensure that individual decisions are not only individual, it's decided by everybody. You would also make sure that there are people whose unusual performance is not going to get you weighed down. Of course, the variance factor itself and the inter-observer variability when you're doing a manual. All this has to be kept in mind. So automated decision rules, having something called automated auto-verification, we'll talk about it a bit later, or automated reflex testing, which might be needed at some times. And it is usually thought that this is applicable primarily to the labs with NIS. I would differ there because you can define the rules and then put the whole thing manually as well. It would be applicable to some analyzers which have only automated analyzers and not a good NIS. This is something which you need to keep in your mind. So therefore, it applies to everybody who uses at least a 5-part nature analyzer. And remember, your quality, service, and cost benefits will always be there the moment you use these systems. Okay, now you have made the rules, you decided the rules, and you want to validate them. So therefore, you will have to look at all the rules in the perspective of what you're looking at, and then finally validate them and give a final answer whether what you've put up, is it right or wrong. So principles of review are, you reduce the number of samples requiring a review to the best possible extent. Analyzers today are fast, low cost, and we've seen a lot of these examples in the previous two presentations. Humans are smart. We know all of us are very smart people, but we are also relatively slower. We have more labor costs, especially in India it may not be so. It may be more that we need abroad, but here also it has started becoming more expensive. And you may, analyzers at times may give you false positives, which is something which a lot of people start thinking that maybe I'm going to review unnecessarily. So criteria for review, again the questions are what is safe, what is most effective, how do we know, and is one's lab experience enough? So there is a very interesting thing which has already been published very well in the literature, and this is from the International Society of Laboratory Hematology. This is on their website. It's also available as a paper in publication. And they have come up with these rules. A lot of them, a huge number of rules which have been formulated. And the aim or the function of this particular committee which they had set up was to develop a set of functional guidelines which will help the laboratories to develop their own set of rules and then work on the basis of them. So many people participated, interestingly none from India. And this is a typical thing which they talk about in this particular case, 2 days, 20 hematologists, 200 sold-out copies, and 2,000 rules. So is it possible for anyone to just keep on going through those 2,000 rules and then finally see a smear? I would rather see a smear. Right? Anyway, so the rules are lying in this particular paper, which is freely available online, and this particular paper actually will help you, if not guide you completely, to design your own rules, and that's what we also did. So for each lab, we'll have our own protocols, and we need to decide as to how we'll analyze this whole data. So we can take consecutive samples, or we can take 1,000 sample data, whatever we decide, and then have a relook at everything, you know, look at them manually also, and at the same time decide the rules that we had drafted, are they being followed or not followed by this particular case. The study which they are quoting, they have used all these analyzers to find it out. In our case, we used our instruments which are being used in our center. Just to give you an idea of what a positive smear findings could be, In RBC morphology 2 plus or more would be taken as a criteria. Morphology again 2 plus or more could be taken as a criteria. And all these were different findings which they talked about in their particular study. It was finally published. So these are various rules which they came about, and the final rules which they had was 41 consensus rules. Okay? And they are all published in that particular paper. These are some of the consensus rules which they are talking about. The white blood cells more than 4,000 and less than 11,000 counts with a white WBC flag, you will do a review, and likewise. Again, some more based on the absolute counts. A few more on the platelet counts. Again, on RBCs. So those were the slide rules which they had defined. Now, these are the slide rules which we have defined in our center. After doing a study for almost 1 week, where we took all consecutive samples daily and had a full review on them by all our team. Of course, you need a smart person like me sitting there to guide everyone, and then you need to have a team as well who have to help you to do all this. All of us did it together. And finally, this is the data that we have from there. So what do we have? Consecutive 15 days, we took all the CBC samples, as you can see, Monday to Saturday trend, again Monday to Saturday trend, and that's how it works. Monday you have a peak and you keep on going down, and that's the average of about 400 samples a day that you would get. All smears were made, and then all smears were looked at with respect to the rules that you had, and you reviewed them. And then finally you got what is called the truth table, based on if the status of the defined rule was triggered, that means it was positive, and on the smear also it was positive, that means it's a true positive. If you had a rule which you had, it was triggered, but you didn't find a positive finding, that means it was a false positive. If you had no triggering, but you found some finding, that means it's a false negative. If it was not triggered and no positive finding was found, it was true negative. So the challenge was, you wanted to make sure that your false negatives are the least. That was your main criteria. And you also wanted to make sure your false positives are not very high, because that will unnecessarily increase your work burden. So this is what we did, and this is the study that we found. We had our false negatives, the red ones, pretty low down there. And by proportion, it was just about 1.78%. Then, I'm sure there would be a question. You said that false negatives have to be as low, but it's still about 2%. What was this? So these were those cases where we had some degree of malaria there in a very low level, which was picked up. So we had flagged either the delta was ignored, or there was a left shift, or there were reactive lymphoid cells, or the malarial parasite in the smear, or there was significant platelet and isocytosis. This is what was the result of the false negatives, and less than 2%. Internationally, most people have it about 4 to 5%. And remember, most of the false positive rates were due to suspect clans. The moment you have a suspect clan, you will make a smear. But it doesn't matter. As long as you are having more, it's okay. You shouldn't have less. So therefore, if I have to give you a take-home message, what do I say? I say, if one wants to go for accreditation, then define, validate, and implement slide review rules. Otherwise, you'll get a non-conformity. Am I trying to say that? No. That's one of the things, yes. But what is more important here is that for optimal use of resources, especially in a setting where you have lots of samples to review, you would first acknowledge the fact that you need to have slide review rules, because most of us don't even want to acknowledge. The second point is define your criteria. Validate these rules, train the staff, very, very important. Get them to understand, implement, revisit at regular intervals, because it's important for you to remember that you should try and ensure that your false negatives are as low as possible. And also update any changes in such reviews. And finally, update the use of Elias or Biddleway used for automated slide review making. I'm sure you must have thought that finishes my presentation. It doesn't. Picture me about me. So what's the thing that I'm going to talk about is something which is about the international standard, where there's a lot of change. I'm sure a lot of you would be either already accredited or in the process of thinking for going for accreditation. So the accreditation is against a standard called 15189. And in this 15189, there is an interesting clause which has been added in 2012, and that's 5.92. And it talks about automated selection and reporting results. Now this is a very interesting thing, you know, because a lot of people would want to know, how will I release my report if everything is normal? I don't want to see it now. Yeah, you don't need to see it. You can just set up rules within your system, and those rules will help you to go ahead and do this. And this all thing is given in this particular guide, which is the CLSI guideline. It's called Auto 10. And anyone can follow this up, but this, the only effect is that it's a paid document. Okay, so expectations, human comfort zones, and vendor issues, these are the issues which you will have to tackle when you are trying to go in for automation for releasing of reports up here. And whenever you try to change anything in any system, these are the phases which you will all go through, even in real lives. So what are the phases? The first phase is the shock and denial. No, I don't want to do it. I'm happy with what I'm doing. Getting angry, because every day when you try to do it, you get frustrated doing a lot of new things. Then you start negotiating with yourself. Finally, you get into a little bit of depression, and then you have a resurgence, and start testing and accepting. These are the phases which you will go through when you try to implement Auto 10 in your system as well. But it is something which is definitely going to help. So what you need to do is, so you plan, you do, you check, and act. So this PDCA cycle has to keep on going for you to come to a final where you are actually able to have all these things on board. The very interesting thing is that you need to develop what is called an auto-verification engine. And this auto-verification engine is based on certain rules which you will have to define based on that particular criteria that I've already mentioned. Once done, you will be able to get to this kind of a state where we are also following. So we have a laboratory reporting system, biological plausibility. If it is validated, yes, then you will need to go ahead and do a evaluation. Otherwise, you can just let it go as a final report. So the take-home message finally is, auto-verification is possible with modern hematology analyzers. It's able to verify, auto-verify high percentage of results, therefore reducing your burden, increases productivity, reduces your turnaround time, reduces the manual review further at times. Paperless environment can be aimed for, and this will be something which can happen potentially in due course of time. Additional capacity to add new tests without adding further staff reduces the opportunities for error and standardized sample and data workflow. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Any questions? I'll be happy to answer.
Thank you for the kind introduction. Last session, and interest trainers for everyone. Set of around 8 to 10 cases. The idea, as the topic says, we all want our cars to be more mileage. What can we do more for the patient, the same or routine CBC test? That's the whole idea. Some of it may be very, very basic, so please, a couple of cases to start with might be very basic use of graphs. But just to highlight, there is so much more that we, a pathologist, are first a physician, and we can think like a physician and help the patient. So that was the idea behind all the cases over here, is what more can I give to the patient? So thanks to the whole organizing team of Happy, thanks to Sesha for having me here. So the idea would be to go see what I can do for the basic parameters and graphs. So even a 3-part or a 5-part, we can do that. What more can we do from Q flags? So there are various analyzers give various flags. Can we use these flags, the newer ones, newer rules? And then comes automated rating, and there are multiple parameters, and I had one or two. I think there's already been a lot of discussion on a few parameters. I'm sorry, I missed that first two talks, but I think IPF was quite extensively covered. So I will skip IPF as such, but other parameters may be a few examples. As far as machines goes, today cases will be from all these four machines. I've been fortunate to have worked on all different models. Started with my learning of KX21. Have had this in my home site at CyclePath Lab for the last 4 years. At Hinduja, I worked on the XC and XM, and this is plug and play which just got installed in our lab 2 weeks ago. So there will be some cases and images with similar systems, and I will show you some cases from each of these systems. So let's start with case one, very simple, and I want not to sort of interact in this because it's all interaction. So this is a 50-year-old female, hemoglobin 12, MCV 78, MCH 22.5. That's the platelet count. Why am I showing this? Is any additional information which you can see from this CBC? What does this represent in a classical scenario?
RBC graph.
There's something in the RBC graph, so let's focus on that. So what can somebody tell me what this RBC graph is all about? So just for people who have not used this analyzer, This is the normal number of cells on this axis, and this is the volume typically in any 3-part, 5-part graph you will see. This represents the platelet zone in this machine, and this represents the RBC zone. And in all the graphs, you will see this dark blue line. This is just like a reference plot. This is normal. Okay. So if this is the reference plot in the background of all the patients, the light blue line is the patient plot. So now, if you can tell me what is happening to this patient, and this is reference, and what are we seeing?
Diamond
population. So which conditions can we see diamond? The first thing you always say is blood transfusion. And my question would be, at a hemoglobin of 12, you know, at the max you would transfuse 1 or 2 units, so at 10 nobody transfuses. So what else could this be? You see a classical, and because it's a dimorphic, the RDW is voted out, but actually speaking it would be 30, 35 or even more. Exactly. So you know, if you think of the physician, the first thing you know, this is patient is possibly treated. So you need to go back to the history, so that's what we did. So if you go back, and this is where, you know, having a delta check, so this machine provides you cumulative data, and we aggressively use it. Okay. So the same patient, just to highlight, 18th of April, so this year, and this first CBC I showed you right now, 16th of May, so almost a month. The hemoglobin is 8.4. And because it's severe anemia, it was iron deficient, indices is iron deficient, RDW was 19.3, MCV was low, MCH was low, and this was a graph, small cells compared to normal cells. Now this patient has been given iron, iron studies was done, it was low, and he has responded beautifully. A very important thing to remember is post-therapy of iron deficiency anemia, everything improves, okay? So your RBC increases, hemoglobin increases, hematocrit, MCV, MCH, the only thing which worsens is RDW. I have just put a figure, though it was voted out, just randomly I showed a figure that RDW increases on therapy because you are having a dimorphic population. This will happen for the next 1 to 3 months because RBC checks life is around 3 months approximately. So what you see is the majority is still the microcytic population, perfectly matching with proton, and then you have some normal cells, and you would say some slightly larger cells, they could be polychromatic macrocytes or reticocytosis in the iron therapy. So just one CBC and you have picked up possibly so many things, and when you speak to the patient, gives a lot of confidence to the patient and as well as to you. We even had a third CBC in this patient. This is just a few days ago. So repeated a CBC, again improvement. But what you see is the change in the graph now. So graph 1, microcytic, graph 2, micro plus some normo and reticocytes. Graph 3, you have less micro and more normo. Again you see hemoglobin is improved to 11.9. RWS to body. So this is just a very simple, you could do on any machine, a follow-up dimorphic population, and not only in blood transfusion. So this could be same in macrocytic or iron deficiency. This is just one representative case. So this is where graphs can be very useful. So let's see how we can use certain rules, certain flags, certain formulas. This is a 24-year-old male, health checkup patient just walked in, hemoglobin 12.7, RBC count 5.78, so slightly lower side for a young male. The indices are 65, MCV, 22 MCH, RDW is 17 or 18. It's the approximate number. So anything on this patient? What do we think of?
Genetic.
Sorry?
Genetic.
What? That. So basically, borderline hemoglobin in a male, higher RBC count. So it could be a mild iron deficiency anemia, it could be a TAC. So we use different formulas. We've done a lot of work on these formulas. We published an index called the Steiger index. I'll show you that paper. So what we have done is, I'll show you the formula. We have fed in, now these newer machines, many of the manufacturers, especially in Sysmex instruments, they allow you to put in some formulas. So this is just a sample patient, and I will show you this rule screen first. Typically what Dr. Anil just spoke to you about slide validation rules. So after you have done your study, you will say that any slide based on your study below 75 you want to have a look at the peripheral smear. Any patient with a platelet count of 1,50,000 you want to make a peripheral smear. Okay, a patient with platelet count more than 6 lakhs, a patient with a count of say 20,000 WBC. What the next step is, now every technician it is very hard to train for them to sustain their activity. You put all those rules in the machine, and what does the machine do? Every time that happens, it will give on your screen, and then go back.
So this is what the machine has given. And this is fed by us. Review slide for low MCV, review slide for low MCH,
BTT, beta thyroid, serum index positive. So we are fed in this formula. Okay. At the operator level, this formula comes and says this patient is suspicious for thalassemia and needs to be screened. So the idea is, you know, every time you don't need to even calculate, you can just put it into the system and it will do it for you. So there are various indices. We are not saying this is the only one, but we have found it very useful in our day-to-day practice. So this was a study done at Hinduja Hospital, and we want to compare this index compared to the protein, like Mendes is very popular, there's a Shine and Love, there's SNK, there are various indices. We were not comparing it as an index for screening in an NGO or in a community, or where you want to screen all patients and label them TAG or not TAG. We are only using this index for a patient who comes to us for a routine CBC. And you say, okay, this patient could be thyroid rate. As pathologists, as I said, we are physicians first. So in every patient, we start writing microcytic hyperchromate is iron deficient TAG. And when the physician says, in every patient I do, does not turn out to TAG, does not turn out to iron deficient, they stop looking at your notes. So what we wanted was, can we improve our specificity? Though TAG typically people say, okay, I want highly sensitive. But what we wanted was sensitive and specific. So we set up some criteria, we evaluated, this paper is freely available, and we have to share. The formula is nothing, it's very simple. It's MCV square by RBC form. We reached a value based on certain statistics, 972. It's no hard and fast value, it could range from 936 to 1000. Okay? Mendes index, typically 13 is what is used as published by Mendes. We tried all 11, 12, 13, 14, and in our hands, 14 gave a very good option. Okay? So between these two indices, you could use it in routine practice. We have trained our lab staff to do it for each and every case so that the patient gets the benefit. One life saved is enough if you could make use of this formula. So this is how another XN patient, so you know, immediately to flag, this is from an XN, that other one is from an XN 350, this is an XN, she suspected a beta thyroid rate immediately. So this is a patient, female patient who came for an antenatal checkup. Again, you have there. So that's on thalassemia, again using indices. We looked at a case of grass, we looked at a case of indices, and next look at some other flags, interesting flags you see. So, very interesting case, 41-year-old male came to us for a routine employment health checkup. So we have a tie-up with one of our clinicians who does only routine health checkups for the hospitality sector, where he has a number of patients that have done routine test. And test asked for routine CBC urine stool and hepatitis B was asked. In any case, the patient had raised blood pressure, otherwise clinically normal, routine CBC was done, and this is what we found. So 45-year-old so adult, hemoglobin 12.4. RBC count on the lower side, so the red indicates that hematocrit lower side, MCP is very high, 119.9. Platelet is borderline low, graph is, looks okay. The graph on the RBC definitely shows macrocytosis as we expect. So what are we dealing with?
Macrocytic
anemia. Alcohol, anything else? So alcohol related neoplastic anemia, B12 deficiency. So like in iron deficiency anemia, you have variation in cell size, because as the iron deficient, iron levels become low, 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 the cell size becomes smaller, 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 so the mixture of cells. The same thing applies for megaloblastic anemia or B12 folate deficiencies, where if we have nutritional deficiency, because today I have some level, then the B12 level is lower, 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 the cells are of different size. That is what causes amygdocytosis or increase in RDW. So what struck me, okay, for such severe MCV, hemoglobin is pretty okay. Okay. You typically expect a severe anemia, look at the RDW, and 12.4. Now what are we dealing with? Extremely rare in a classical megaloblastic anemia with such high MCV to have a normal RDW. So the correlation tells you something over here. Any other condition you would have seen that this happens? It's rare, but it's not uncommon. It's something which you can easily pick up. So drug-induced macrocytosis is a big thing. Now this is especially seen with antivirals, okay? Especially with patients who are on zidovudine or HIV. Now, this case was particularly interesting. We have seen this very often in all our follow-up CBC patients in the HIV OPD, you see it very often. This came with an employment health checkup. We had not declared. At our level, we immediately did, this is rare, so this is MCV and RDW is what I want to highlight. This is the morphology. So you see large macrocyte, it's uniform. Because it's drug-induced, after a point of say 15 days, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, the process is uniform on all the RBCs. So they are all macrocytes. There is no anisocytosis. So the RDW is normal. So this is what drug-induced picture in cause. we actually did a dry dot test for this patient, it was positive. And when we confronted the patient, the clinician confronted, he was actually HIV positive. And he was actually taking zidovudine. And there are enough papers when you read it that actually MCV is used as a marker to evaluate whether the patient is compliant with zidovudine or not. This is an excellent paper. And in at least whenever we get this follow-up HIV patients, if we get to meet CD4, CD8, follow their CBCs, you know if this patient was zidovudine, how is he performing. So you can see this with this high microsatellite with certain drugs, antivirals, there are other drugs which also call it. Some folate antagonists cause it, but generally the MCV is not that high. 118-120 MCV with RDW typically antivirals. So this is another interesting finding. Not knowing any clinical history, but thinking like a physician, you know there is something else in the background. Okay, so graphs, indices, RDW, let's move to flags. 8-year-old male child, fever for the last 1 week. He was in a government hospital being treated for nephrotic syndrome and developed fever with wheezing. Visited a private pediatrician who suspected chest infection. What they said is we want a CBC, ESR, chest X-ray to start with. I think they had also asked for a Vidal test in this patient. The CBC. 8-year-old male, 16,000 count, hemoglobin 12, microcytic hyperchromic indices, RW is high, possibly iron deficient also, 181 platelet count. Okay. And the graph is there. So, neutrophil not reported, there's some problem with the basophils, but they are approximately 70%. Matches with so-called history, nephrotic syndrome, patient has a VS suspecting a pneumonia, there is a neutrophilia with actual neutrophil leukocytosis. I said this is straightforward. But there's something which we have been using again in the lab for the last 3 years. And particularly on this excess machine, it gives this flag. This is called the PRBC flag. It's a Q flag. We have actually used this in qualitative study and I showed you some results. This is parasitized RBC flag. Okay. This works for PYVAX only. It's at no extra cost. And what it does is it causes a purple color cluster over here, and there is also, if you go to the Q flag screen, there is a Q flag screen video value more than 300. In this particular patient, the moment I saw the flag, I put in the slide, actually turned out to be a mixed phenotypic, mixed infection. So we have the aqueous forms. This is the YVAX. It's a rare case to find mixed. I have not seen one maybe in the last 2 years, so the only one. Typically, we see classical PYVAX, it works very well. And this is a rapid malaria test, you see both the bands in this case. So again, 16,000 counts, unexpected in the malaria. Okay. Normal platelet are 180, but he had iron deficiency, so maybe he had some reactive platelets. And he has malaria, but he was not presenting like a classical malaria. So clinician was very happy, that's where the PRBC flag helped me immediately diagnose. I'm not saying it's specific, let me see the data how it works. So in this analyzer, based on fluorescent flow cytometry, the parasitic RBC form a purple dot cluster over here. Additional flag is generated. It's an automatic flag, you don't do anything. So we wanted to evaluate, can I use it in practice on a day-to-day basis? So the aim was to evaluate the sensitivity and specificity of this flag only for YVAX in compared to the gold standard which still remains microscope. So in the year of 2014, 3 to 4 months, we had 667 cases of clinically suspected malaria. So there's a bias in selection, which is part of the study. One case diagnosed as P. falciparum, so we excluded it from statistics because this flag is only for YVAX. 68 diagnosed cases of YVAX based on a combination of microscopy and a rapid malaria antigen test. So we analyzed 666 statistically cases were evaluated. This is the result. So, gold standard microscopy and our rapid malaria, total 68 were positive, 57 picked up by this flag, 11 were missed. So, 11 false negatives, 2 false positives. So, 2 cases we had, one of the CM and one of the polycythemia level. And we know whenever we have had high counts, leukemic cases, abnormal, it does show, there are certain other times also it shows a false positive, which we have seen across the board. So, no way is this a specific 100%, this is the only thing, but it tells you, okay, let's look at a slide a little more carefully. So this flag comes when the Q flag value is above 100, that's the limit set by the company. So what we appreciated even more was of these 11 cases, 9 of these had a PRBC Q flag on the Q flag screen, not on the, it was less than 100, and the values range from 20 to 90. So, essentially, out of 68, 66 of them showed some kind of an algorithmic change as a flag, which tells me I need to screen these cases and look more actively If I have screened it 5 minutes, screen for 10, maybe make a thick smear, maybe make a, even do a rapid malaria kit, because one, everybody doesn't spend as much time in malaria, being very frank, then rapid malaria can be useful. So this is what we did. So in our lab for the last 3 years, if any patient shows a PRBC flag, we screen on the slide. If we don't see the slide, even if the patient is not built for it, we always do a rapid malaria test when the Q flag value is above 70. So 80, 90, 100 and above, for all patients, if we don't see, we do a rapid malaria test. So extremely useful. Once every time we see a case unsuspected, no test asked for empty and the machine picks it up for us. So again, highly useful parameter to have. So take home message, useful screening tool. That's what I put it as. In day-to-day practice, not 100% is not the answer, but the flag warrants confirmation by the microscope. So moving on from there, going on to the reticulocyte mode parameters. This is a paper we published in 2013 on the XE, where we have published a lot of these research parameters, what are the normal reference ranges in this set of patients. And we started generating these reports. Many people are using these parameters now. And the retic count, reticulocyte production index, immature retic fraction, reticulocyte hemoglobin IPR, there is some explanation. So when we started, the physicians, the laboratorians want to know what more can we do with this test. So just to show you a couple of cases of how we use a reticulocyte. Before we go, we need to know what normal is. So this is a normal patient. It's not called a patient, normal health checkup sample. Hemoglobin 13.5, normal WBC, normal platelet. Retic is 0.85. In a normal retic count, 0.22 is what traditionally we consider. In our hands, in this machine, we had a count of around 0.3 to 1.5, roughly the same range. So this is perfectly what is normal. So typically we know aplastic anemia, kind of a severe anemia, we want to do retic. Hemoglobin 7.2, the retic is very low, the marrow is not responding. This is typically what we say in a low retic response. So we know retic helps. And at very such low counts, the automated retic is very useful. Because manually you may actually not pick it up, there is no internal control, we don't know if the stain has worked, so this is useful. Now let's look at this patient. 7-year-old female child, anemia, hemoglobin was 9, retic was 12.61%. So this is 12.61%. So what does that tell you? There is a, so even if you corrected this, the hematocrit is 26. If you consider normal hematocrit around 45, one will calculate our corrected retic count around 7.5, 8, whatever the figure will come. And then you also want to calculate the reticulocyte production index. That's the thing these days, I need to calculate RPI. So this is corrected for the days the reticulocyte lives in the marrow or the peripheral blood. So when there's an increased retic response, reticulocytes are released early from the marrow, they go into the peripheral blood. Instead of spending 1 day, they spend 2 days. So you need to correct for that because you get a slightly higher count. Simply speaking, how do you use it? RPI more than 2, suggestion of blood loss, less than 2 is inadequate response. So rather actually sitting and calculating, the machine gives you a value, RPI 3.9. Clear cut, no. This is a high retic response. The anemia is not severe, but the retic response is pretty high. So something is happening. Accompanying information, platelet is 17,000. So hemolytic anemia with low platelets. Anything you would suspect or want to do next?
Evans.
That is one condition, exactly. We always look at the peripheral smear. This is what we saw. So you see microspinocytes, 1, 2, 3. You see nice schistocytes. Case of microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. Patient had HUS-TTP, a young female patient. So, you know, low platelets, high retic count, anemia, the advantage of doing all these parameters. Then there is this paper which is recommendation for automated schistocyte count. I mean, this is very interesting. If you read through this paper, it says it's a good screening tool if you can use fragmented red cells, but it has to be used in conditions where you are not seeing other RBC abnormalities, and that includes iron deficiency anemia, which in our country is very, very high. But it is a very high negative predictive value. So if you can define the cutoff 1%, 2%, and if the on the machine the cutoff is lower than that, typically, it is far more sensitive than the manual. You can see there are no schistocytes. Have I used it that way? No. What we have done is for our patients, of few patients when they are in Gujarat, who were every day the physician wanted to know they are in plasmapheresis, what is the schistocyte count today. Patient who was on post kidney transplant with tacrolimus, developed thrombotic microangiopathy, they wanted to know what is it improving or not. So we found this fragmented red cell percentage a very useful tool. And we compared manual schistocyte counts, and we went by the ICH guidelines to know which type of cell to be counted as schistocyte, what are the numbers per 1,000, we did actual counts, and we compared it to the. So So just to highlight, just one reticulocyte more, you had a retic count, you had an RPI, you have the absolute retic count, you have the fragmented red cells, you have other parameters, you even have your platelets, different types which we have discussed earlier. So this is just to highlight how automated retic can help in a given scenario. Any questions on this case? So there is another reticulocyte mod parameter. It's retic hemoglobin. So what it tells you is, this is a cathodic parameter which tells us about the indirectly about the hemoglobin content of the reticulocytes. So the idea is, before RBC there are the reticulocytes. If the reticulocytes have a lower hemoglobin content, we can potentially say that is functional iron deficiency. That means from the marrow, reticulocytes are not getting enough iron. Okay, so it helps us especially in conditions of anemia of chronic disease, patients who are on chronic chemotherapy, cancer patients who are being followed up, where giving iron or not iron is not as simple, because you could have iron overload. Iron is also causes oxidative stress. You need to know whether to give iron or not to give iron. So how we used it? We first in our paper we knew this is normal reference range is 28 to 34, published is 28 to 25, so we are on the same lines. As part of a thesis project for one of our DMD students at Hinduja, we did analysis on 184 samples. Normal samples around 96, 71 were iron deficiency anemia, and 17 were beta thalassemia, all proven with their biochemical test experiences and everything for all the patients. We wanted to get a cutoff. What is the range in normal? What is the range in iron deficiency anemia? And your beta thal will also have a lower range because of the microcytosis. So normal 28.7 to 34, IDA, the range we got was 18 to 28, and beta thal was overlapping with the IDA range. So based on area under the curve and statistical analysis, we created a cutoff. We said to differentiate IDA and normal patients, one cutoff which we might use is 28. And we compared our results to for red HE to different papers, and it ranged from 25 to 29.8. It's about your data, what you do and what cutoff you use in your lab based on your values. It's again a screening cutoff which one can use in special circumstances. Beware if the patient has concomitant B12 deficiency or a macrocytosis, red HE will be normal or high. So it is not foolproof. You always, whenever you use this parameter, you need to know the pros and cons of all these parameters. Like I said, FRC, fragmented red cells, iron deficiency anemia, you might see large number of cases because it's small RBCs and they might be fragment. You run a whole sample, you run a hemolyzed sample, you will see FRC. So again, pros and cons of each and every parameter you need to know. So how we use this? Just to highlight one of the cases we use. Again, a normal sample, same which I showed you, 13.5, normal LCV, normal RW, 12.982, so no problem. Classical iron deficiency, 7.5, low LCV, 66.6, very high RW, 24.1, iron deficient anemia. So you know you will give iron. So red HE in normal, 30, as I said, range was 28-34, in iron deficient, 24.9, but the LCV told you the answer. Okay? So you didn't need the red HE only. Let's see a patient of anemia of chronic disease. Typically, 8-9 levels of hemoglobin. Now the MCV is 89, MCH is 27. Now what do I do? It is not helping me. The RDW is 15. There is no way this is indicating iron status. You see the red HE is 25.8. Okay? So here it tells me that this patient along with erythropoietin might benefit with additional iron. Now this is what we are working on currently and needs to be collaborated with next step of our project, which we have planned, is to do iron studies in all patients with ACD and see whether this is natural. And this needs to be validated, but this is currently how we are trying to screen patients. We definitely do iron studies for these patients.
For patients with red HE is normal, at least you may get away without doing it. That comes with an added cost. I'm not going into IPF, it's been extensively discussed. This is already done with dengue and other things, so I'm not doing it. So the last case, for the day, and this is just to highlight that in spite of automation, we need to keep our eyes, mind, ears, everything open, because there are times when there are problems. So this is, and I would like to see if you have seen something. This thing troubled us for a couple of years before we found what the answer was. This patient had a WBC very low, only 250 cells, hemoglobin of 8.5. The platelet count given by the machine was 1,39,000. So obviously for various reasons the slide was made, not only for platelet low, WBC anemia, part of our validated rules. The peripheral smear showed only 1 to 2 platelets per hypertrophy. So have any of you come across a picture where the machine reports a higher count and actually don't see it on the scene? So one common condition is severe microcytosis. So typically first thing I want to look is how is the RBC plaque, is it touching the baseline? Yes it is. And look at the MCV, it is 75, RDW is high but it's not very high. So that severe microcytosis kind of thing is sort of ruled out. So next thing, when you have the benefit of doing optical or fluorescent platelet count, because you know if it is RBCs are severely microcytic or there is some debris because the machine is counting particles, that's the logic. It is over counting, we want to make one more smear, rule out label, rule out mix up, rule out all those kind of pre-analytical errors. We ran the same sample on an optical platelet count, the machine gave a value of, so if you see fluorescent platelet count, it is 10,000. Now this matches to what we are seeing on the platelet smear. This used to happen with us, say 2 to 3 times in a year, randomly. Okay, we ran it on 2 or 3 machines, all impedance based, it would always give a high count. We thought it was expiry of microtenors, we tried everything and we didn't know what the answer was. Okay. In this particular patient, it so happened that WBC and all is also low, but we have seen 1 or 2 patients with, the only thing was platelet was 2 lakhs, by chance for some MP or some other reason a slide was made. So imagine if the platelet is normal and you not made a slide only, so you would sort of, especially with what Dr. Anil was saying, automation.
Go back to your previous slide. So I'll tell you what Kanchan answers to this, because we've had this problem.
Yes.
And
exactly, you're the answer.
I'm giving you Kanchan's answer.
Yes.
Because we've had this many times. So we'll send her the screenshot of this and say, and you know what she'll say? She'll say, but if the machine is saying 239 with asterisk, you have to make a slide.
And abnormal distribution.
It is her always constant answer.
So now what happens is any company, if you put an asterisk, it is always. But how often do we see asterisks in normal CBCs?
It comes
as
often.
Very often.
Yeah.
Okay.
We see almost every alternate.
Exactly. So
with
this new interfacing, LIS and automation rules, are you going to make a slide for each and every patient? Practically no. But something over here tells, and that's where technician training or operator training is important. Look at the plated graph. This is highly unusual. Even in the case of giant platelets, you will see that this graph goes down matches with the RBC. Here it is just like a flat line. The machine does not know where to put the cutoff. Should I put it here? Should I put it here? Should I put it here? It has no clue. That's the reason a slide should be made. In almost all the cases when we have gone back, where we have faced this problem, even the 180 count or 2 lakh count, yes, it has given the asterisks. Yes, it has given platelet abnormal distribution which comes in normal. But the graph has been highly abnormal. So you are thinking, there has to be some reason. And the simple answer was we spun the sample, it was hemolyzed. Okay, and we never spin CBC samples. And if you now logically think, the RBC fragment, for whatever reason, collection problem, was it intravascular, extravascular, is the next step you want to go. Okay, and it was all hemolyzed and they were all fragments. What happened in the optical count? The RBC fragments are all here, and I'll show that to you. So one we saw a smear, we called for a fresh sample. This is a fresh sample of the same patient, and this is a platelet impedance count. There is no AND and F written over here. The count is 22,000. So it's a low platelet count. This sample was not utilized from this also. It matched with the smear. So now as a rule, what you have done, whenever there is this mismatch, just spin your sample. There will be hemolysis. And I always share with my staff, if there is hemolysis in one sample in your lab, it will affect other parameters. So coagulation we spin, there is hemolysis we pick up, but CBC we don't. So look back, if there is an electrolyte being done, potassium, look back, if other biochemistries are being done, hemolysis. So again, the idea is how these small things can help you. This may not be the only cause, but this is what, now we have used it, and every so often when it happens, this turns out to be the cause. This is all that I have. Thank you so much. I would like to thank Dr. Shenaz, Dr. Preeti and the whole Hindra team, because a lot of my work in the last 5 years was done at that lab. Neha, my colleague, and my current team at my lab. Meenakshi and Monisha, both from Sysmex Indian team, have worked with me to help me with the data on the malaria. They helped in collecting the data when it was new to us. And Transitia team have always been very supportive for all these kind of projects. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for the informative answer.
Kundal,
in patient, if we do the platelet count, the machine feeds somewhat higher value than what we see on this media. And this is very specific for post-transplant. Is it the same fragmented RBC?
So, there are a lot of variables when we are comparing a machine to what we see manual count. So then a different question comes, how did you do it? Did you do it on Eva chamber? Did you do a manual count on a peripheral smear? Then you did an estimate of a platelet count. How much is the microscope area? What multiplication factor you use? 10,000, 15,000, 20,000. So it becomes. So now, what I personally use to differentiate the two, if in a normal platelet count, say, in a range, for example, 1 lakh to 4 lakhs or 1 lakh to 3 lakhs, because on the lower side and the higher side, manual is very difficult. If your manual observation is plus minus 10-15%, the machine is going to be more accurate than your eye. But like in the previous case, machine is 1 lakh 40 and you see 10,000, that is something is amiss. So if you say 1 lakh and 50,000, something is amiss. So then you need to screen, rule out other things, cross check whether those are giant platelets. Now what you are saying, machine is over counting. It depends, it's very tricky. There could be, as you said, if there is hemolysis, if there is other problems, because that's where the impedance counts will not always be correct, because they are only counting particles. So if you go on to the next generation of optical or fluorescent counts, it is useful in these scenarios. So that's where, you know, using this technology to your optimum is what we recommend.
So the counts
given
higher
side,
even though it is low, any other factor other than fragmented RBC? Because we had a greatest
yes.
problem having the patient dengue. We have given 10,000, next 12,000 per day.
No, then we need to confirm it with two samples and prove. Yeah,
so sample we got 1,39,000. Then immediately we have seen the triad was the nearly 25,000.
More common cases I personally have seen is severe microcytosis, cystocytes, fragmented, or hemolysis. Personally, I have not seen that, but maybe not Swati or Tamil.
I've heard cases in which malaria is being counted there.
That's true. That's true. Because it's a fluorescent thing and that will get counted. So, yeah, sure.
Sorry.
We are going to make just three announcements. We are all meeting today at 6 o'clock. We are meeting today at 6 o'clock outside our ballroom for a group photograph. The location is near the swimming pool, but we will all take you there, you know, to take a beautiful picture of all of us. Number two, we will be meeting at 7:15 or so in the ballroom again for entertainment and dinner. And three, tomorrow morning we have arranged breakfast sessions in some breakouts, you know, seven halls. There are seven topics. So, what we request is you can go and have a look at the halls, the locations and the topics today and decide which one you want to attend. Breakfast will be served inside these halls between 8 to 9:30. No breakfast is going to be served outside like today, because we want all of us to be interacting with our partners and the topics, obviously. After that, the conference starts at 10 o'clock in the ballroom. Yeah? Sorry.
The breakfast would be served for residents
and non-residents. Nothing outside. Yeah? Sorry.
6 o'clock.
This is what I personally think, but we'll come across other things.
Yeah. Breakfast menu is going to be same in all the halls.
Okay, thank you.
That's what is important.
Very important suggestion. Spherocytes on a CBC. So typically people say MCHC more than 36 is suggestive of spherocytes, but in my perception, not in so many cases it not doesn't happen.
You have iron deficiency
yes.
along with it.
So many things are happening. So if you start saying 34, 35 with iron deficient indices, MCHC is on the higher side, then you can start thinking. MCHC 36 and above typically more often happens in cold agglutinin disease, other interfering factors, rather than spherocytes. So ultimately, thankfully, there is something for us pathologists to look on the side.
What about cold agglutinin?
Typically, MCHC is highly abnormal, 40, 42, 45, you see the agglutination. MCV is abnormal, MCH of the parent may not be, there may be abnormal curves, there may be hemolysis happening. You actually need to, you know, prove that on a slide. Yes, it will be abnormal, right? Agglutination flag.
Yeah.
And the typical thing is you incubate at 37 degrees for 30 minutes to an hour, rerun it, it will improve. It will not become back to normal, but it significantly improves, and that's almost like a proof that this is cold different disease. What more can you do in that? Look for malaria, or look for atypical lymphocytes, look for abnormal cells, ask the history of the patient. Mycoplasma pneumonia is very common, pneumonia patients, rare malaria patients, CMVs, lymphomas, protein electrophoresis. So, you know, you can start looking at all those angles. Again, be a physician, not only a pathologist.
What would glucoformation
affect the CBC motor? I have not. Glucoformation on a CBC machine, I have not seen.
It increases your mean corpuscular volume and there is a shift to the right.
Yes.
Of the red cell. But it doesn't actually when you have MC, your rule is like really large. Otherwise, usually it doesn't.
Because they're not sticking to each other, it's an artifact on our slide because of the increased progress. On the machine with good diamonds and good foldings, it shouldn't really matter. No more questions. Thank you so much for your patient hearing. Thanks a lot.
So in case of severe fever, the count rating
of
the machine
use,
should we give that or should we calculate the index
rating index? So two different questions. One is, are you asking me manual versus readily? I would do it in all patients. Because the machine is.
If you ask for ready count.
It depends on your lab policy. So, in our lab, currently what we do is if somebody asks me for ready, I give everything. Retic, Ret HE, IRF, IPF, RPI, absolute ready count, and give a reason, you know, how it can be used. So, then you can still calculate based on your. Hematocrit and their correction formulas.
So, is there a criteria that you have to give retinal in severe anemia or you should give it with every?
You should not be used in patients who do not have anemia. That's one policy for RPI because this is a calculation for anemic patients. And for normal hemoglobins of female above 12 or male above 13, do not use it. Otherwise, I would encourage to use it because the more we use, the more we learn.
But is there a retinal index? There is no assess rate. So, how do you report it?
There's a cutoff, and again, on the machine, the company gives it as more than 2, less than 2, again, the data, and we have used it in our cases. But we have also seen that more than 3 is highly suggestive of hemolytic, 2 to 3 may be borderline, less than 2 is suggestive to be impaired myo response, but less than 1 is definitely impaired myo response. So again, the more we have used, we have realized less than 1, and more than 3 is highly specific. 1 to 3 might be variable again, so you cannot use one single parameter and claim to know everything. The balance of morphology. Peripheral smear. Thankfully, as I said, pathologists have a big role. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Swati. Thank you for being here.
Excuse me.
Dr. Matthews. Dr. Ali Nandu. And of course, Dr. Kunal Sahil. And many thanks to our conveners of the workshop, Dr. Mehul Desai and Dr. Suresh Sahil. Please. Thank you, ma'am, for doing the honors.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you all for being a wonderful audience. We thank ABPI for giving us this opportunity.